Our business this morning is a debate on motion number 190 in the name of Fiona Hislop on Scotland's future in the European Union. I call on Fiona Hislop to speak and to move the motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name. First of all, I would like to take a moment to welcome colleagues here today in their new positions, Jackson Carlow for the Conservatives and Lewis MacDonald for Labour. Presiding Officer, there are only 28 days until the polls open for the EU referendum and votes are cast across Scotland and the rest of the UK on whether we should remain in or leave the European Union. And although the opinion polls in Scotland give support to remain a lead, there is no room at all for complacency in Scotland, and polls are indeed tight across the UK. All the parties represented in this chamber have leaders who are committed to Scotland's continued EU membership. Their arguments for a Remain vote may differ, as we will hear today, but the bottom line is that we are faced with a stark choice. Do we remain in the EU or leave? There will be no qualifications on the ballot paper. It is simply, do we leave or do we remain? And of course, there may be voices to leave heard today. The EU is not perfect. It is always changing, and it needs to improve to ensure it focuses on what matters to people's lives, jobs, the economy, energy and general security, and the environment. And the position of the Scottish Government is clear, though. Being in the EU is far better for the people of Scotland than being out. Scotland wants and deserves to see arguments which are rational, reasoned, and which respect the intelligence of one of the most politically engaged electorates in Europe. Today, I will concentrate on the benefits of Scotland's EU membership, and I hope the Chamber can unite between our call for a vote to remain in the European Union on June the 23rd. I will address what the EU has delivered in the past, what it is delivering in the present, and what the prospects are for the future. The EU is founded on the principles of solidarity and mutual support. Its past is a past born out of the needs of European countries to prioritise cooperation over conflict in the post-war years and shape a better world for their children and grandchildren. And the EU is much more than a simple trade association. It is based on the principles of strengthening peace, security, justice and prosperity for all. Those aims are embedded in the rights which EU legislation guarantees for the people of Scotland. And these important rights cover areas ranging from civil liberties to consumer protection. And EU legislation for a social Europe has been a force for good, preventing the exploitation of workers. The EU has guaranteed that workers cannot be forced to work longer than a 48-hour week, that they will be entitled to 20 days paid leave per year, and that women will be entitled to at least 14 weeks of maternity leave. It is the EU that guarantees these rights, and it is most certainly not a given that these rights and protections would continue in a UK government outside the EU. In 2013, the UK only increased the minimum entitlement to parental leave as a direct result of European directives. And there are other cases, for example, minimum annual leave and conditions for agency workers where the UK complies with the European minimum and no more. EU action has been a major driver of progressive legislation which directly benefits the people of Scotland. And Dr. Allen was making this case in Brussels earlier this week in his first visit in his new role as Minister for Europe. And as of now, in the present day, we know that these rights are guaranteed to all Scots who choose to work, live and study elsewhere in the EU. We all know many Scots who have benefited from opportunities to live, to work, study and elsewhere in the EU. And the EU membership has opened up these benefits to us. And if we want them to be available to our children and our grandchildren, we have to communicate their worth to the people of Scotland between now and June the 23rd. The Scottish Government has this week published information and web pages setting out the benefits of EU membership. And migration from the EU has also benefited the communities, businesses and people of Scotland. EU migrants make a substantial net contribution to the UK's public finances and address crucial skills gaps in Scotland's economy. In my own portfolio, the tourism industry needs access to European workers. And according to a new HMRC report this month, in 2013-14, recent EU migrants contributed over £2.5 billion more to the UK Treasury in taxes, contributing to paying for our public services than they received back. They are welcome contributors to our economy and to our society. And we need to recognise, indeed,
I agree with the Cabinet Secretary's observations about the contribution EU migrants make to Scotland and indeed to the UK, but would she also illustrate to the Chamber whether any assessment has taken place on the impact of our NHS were Brexit to take place, given how many doctors, nurses and other health staff, of course, come from other EU countries?
Well, indeed, NHS Scotland have been one of the contributors to the case to the UK government to make sure that we can have a migration system that works for Scotland, for our public services, and a point well made that our NHS in particular is very dependent on the very skilled and very welcome medical staff that we have in our hospitals. And that's why we need to recognise the positive contribution that EU and indeed other migrants make to Scotland. But isn't it interesting, Presiding Officer, why are UK nationals living and working abroad referred to as expats, while workers from the rest of the EU working here are called migrants? Now, I want to move on to the issue about the environment and climate change. Protecting our environment, tackling climate change is a global challenge. European decisions have helped us to reduce sulfur dioxide emissions by almost 9/10 in the last 4 decades, and nitrogen oxide levels have decreased by 2/3 in Scotland since 1990. And we have to act collectively to solve these problems. Environmental issues cross borders and geographies. And the EU sets standards for European nations, and its projects encourage the cooperation and innovation necessary to develop new technologies, including renewables. And that's a particular benefit for Scotland. And only this week, over £500 million worth of EU investment in the Moray Firth Beatrice wind farm was announced. And this project will eventually be worth £2.5 billion and deliver many employment and community benefits to Caithness and to Scotland as a whole. And being in the EU puts Scotland in the vanguard of the global effort against climate change. Ahead of last year's Paris summit, the EU was able to negotiate far more effectively as representative of 28 member states than any of those member states would have done on their own. And cooperation across borders is a necessity in today's interconnected world, whether it be climate negotiations or the current refugee crisis currently facing the EU. International problems require countries to work together more, not less. And I want to say something about sovereignty. I believe that Scotland should be an independent country precisely so it can decide itself with which bodies, organisations it can pool or share its sovereignty with as an independent nation in an interdependent world. The economic benefits, Presiding Officer, of EU membership are well known. Yep, indeed.
Mr Findlay.
I wonder if the Minister could expand on her logic of wanting to leave a political union of 60 million to join a political union of 750 million, and if she believes... And if she believes that Scotland would have more influence in that scenario.
I think I've just made the case why independent countries, 28 of them in the EU, can decide themselves to be part of a market. If he wants to join with others to take the UK and Scotland out of the 500 million, then he can align himself with Boris Johnson. More than 300,000 Scottish jobs estimated by the Centre for Economic and Business Research are deemed to be associated with exports to the EU. Of course, 42% of exports from Scotland go to the EU. And of course, Scotland, unlike the UK as a whole, is a net exporter to the EU, perhaps an economic lesson Mr Findlay might want to take up. This week, Ernst & Young revealed that foreign direct investment in Scotland has risen by 50% in 2015, securing over 5,000 jobs. And their survey also found that 79% of investors cited access to the European single market as a key feature of the UK's attractiveness. Now, I'm not saying that this would halt to a crash if the UK were to leave the EU. But I do believe that our EU membership makes investing in Scotland more attractive and an easier prospect. And I'm frequently told so when I meet partners across the world, and this was especially true during my visit to Japan last year. And there is clear evidence that exporting helps business to become more innovative and successful. And our priority as a Scottish government is to create jobs in Scotland by leveraging our EU membership to grow our exports. Being within the single market is vital for Scottish businesses to have the best possible opportunities in Europe. Presiding Officer, 7 of the top 10 destinations for our most significant exporting sector, food and drink, are within the EU. And our new investment and innovation hubs we're establishing in Dublin, London and Brussels will contribute to that effort and are an example of our government's international ambition, which our EU membership facilitates. And facing the future, being within the EU offers a better chance to tackle the international big challenges of energy security, climate change, and international pressures. There is no agreement or detail from the Leave side about what they are offering for the future. An arrangement similar to Norway's would leave us subject to all the same rules and as contributors to the EU budget, but without any say in setting those rules or how the budget is allocated. As a former foreign minister of Norway has said, they pay but have no say. Norway is the 10th highest contributor to the EU budget and has to pay into it to have access to the EU funds like Horizon 2020. Norwegian farmers do not receive cap payments. And we should also remember that Norway has decided to join Schengen and is now subject to freedom of movement rules. Outside the single market, the idea that the UK should model itself on Singapore doesn't even get off the ground, particularly given the importance the Singaporean government places on its membership of ASEAN. And I said at the outset that different parties will come to this debate with different perspectives, but I do hope that we can unite across parties behind the motion and provide leadership to the Scotland in the vote ahead.
Colleen Smith.
Thank you, Minister. Just on that point of different views, you seem to indicate earlier that anyone who was taking a Leave view was aligning themselves with Boris Johnston. Would that mean that anyone who's taking a Remain view would align themselves with David Cameron? And surely this debate has got to be much, much more than one old Etonian versus another old Etonian.
We can take a historical perspective. The Archbishop of Canterbury is currently addressing the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland, and perhaps some might actually look at the historical perspectives of where we are now in terms of what's happening in this debate being about an English civil war, but a civil war within the Tory party. This issue is quite stark. It's bigger than any of this in terms of the internal dynamics within the Conservative Party. This has got to be, as the member says, about the future of not just this country, but the European Union as a whole, and our impact on the wider world. And I think in particular, I want to pay tribute to this Parliament and to the committee in the last Parliament, the European and External Affairs Committee, for the work they did in bringing together a consensus of across Scotland, different voices from different perspectives. But let me be quite clear, we as a Parliament have to show political leadership to the people of Scotland, and that's what we intend to do with the motion today. And I want to appeal to all involved in this debate, to the Leave campaign to cease their smears, their speculation, and their downright ludicrous arguments, and to the Remain campaign to realise that if the biggest risk is complacency at the polls, then their incredible Project Fear tactics will dissuade, not persuade, voters to turn out at the polls. The EU is not perfect, but it is a remarkable achievement that in over six decades, it has secured cooperation over conflict, pursued a shared sense of collaboration, exchange and purposeful endeavour to work in concert, not just to advance the interests of its own members, but the world on a global scale. And it is on that positive basis that the Scottish Government is of the view that Scotland, as part of the UK, should remain in the EU.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Jackson Carlow.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by thanking the Cabinet Secretary for her welcome after 9 years shadowing the health portfolio. It will indeed be fun to share a different portfolio and to lock horns with her. This, of course, is not for the Conservative Party a party position. She was perfectly correct to identify that the leaders of all the political parties are in favour of Remain, as I am myself. But it is a personal position that I'm advocating in the debate here this morning. It's 40 years ago since the last referendum on Britain's membership with the European Union. 67% of people said yes in 1975, 32% of people said no. In fact, the only no votes cast anywhere in the whole of the United Kingdom, where Mr. Allen's constituency of the Western Isles and Mr. Scott's constituency of the Shetland Isles, both of whom voted no in that contest. It was a turnout of 65%, and I think there is a question mark at the moment as to whether or not people are sufficiently engaged to ensure that we have a turnout of that level as well. But it's important that we do, because as the Cabinet Secretary said, this is a fundamentally important decision. 1975 and that referendum was the last election in which I did not participate. After that, I was old enough to vote. But at 16, I was able to watch with interest the debate that took place. And when I hear many of the people who talk about leaving, as if somehow that is going to lead to some sort of economic utopia for Britain, I think back to 1975, an economic and social utopia it was not. It may be that the legacy in the minds of some is the music of Slade and T-Rex and Wizard and Roxy Music and David Bowie, but you know, the top-rated television programmes, just to identify how distant that life was, were Till Death Us Do Part and The Black and White Minstrel Show. This was a very, very different Britain in a very different age. It was a time when our industrial record measured the days lost through dispute in millions. And for us looking back to a vote 40 years ago, it's also important to remember for those that did vote, the Second World War was only 30 years earlier than that. And for many of my grandparents' generation who had fought and who had raised families during those conflicts, the European alliance held the prospect of a permanent peace and level of cooperation. And although in 1975 those fears proved to be unrealized, we sat in Europe next to the Soviet Union, and there was a perceptible and genuine fear that if we weren't to see further conflict across the European mainland, the European project, being part of the European Economic Community as it was then, was a decisive step forward for the country. And in that we are correct. The battlefields of Europe are now the holiday playgrounds of Europeans. That is a significant change in the step of life across the European continent, and one that people too easily dismiss and now set aside as if it was something that was always inevitable and something which is irrelevant. But it was a broken economy in 1975. I don't remember it prospering. We'd just come from a three-day week where businesses could only work for 3 days. I remember the power cuts. I remember candles in the home. I remember Edward Heath saying, "Britain has reached the end of the road. The rest of the world is very sorry, but the rest of the world regrets it can oblige no longer." I remember the Labour Party having to return back from crisis meetings at the IMF. And 40 years on, our nation is transformed. Not despite, not because of, but within the European community. All the progress we've made as a nation was made within the European community. Now, I'm not arguing that all our success was due to that, far from it, but it was born out of exceptional political courage here. But the idea that the European community somehow acted as a brake on our prosperity, somehow interfered with all our economic taxation and industrial and economic policy, is an absolute nonsense. And within the European Union, it was the United Kingdom that drove through the single market, the key economic driver of change. Again, it's easy to forget the queues of lorries that were at every border post across every European nation, having to wait for days sometimes before goods could be transported between the various countries of Europe. All that has been swept aside, and Britain has been on the winning side of much of the argument about how we transform and develop Europe and the policy within Europe during that period. Now, sometimes I hear colleagues talk about this colossal loss of sovereignty. And I don't know sometimes what is defined by sovereignty. Is it that we should seal our borders? Is it we should stick it to anyone who's got an interest in human rights? I don't know. Is that what's meant by sovereignty? Because for me, the day-to-day existence in my life, whether it be on education policy, whether it be in health policy, whether it be in economic policy, whether it be in taxation, is actually decided here or is decided at Westminster without, as far as I'm concerned, any great interference from Europe. In meaningful terms, the sovereignty of policy in this country rests with people in this country. And I think that the interference and the dead hand of Europe is sometimes exaggerated for effect rather than in any respect to its reality. Yes, on issues of justice and on some issues of our rural economy and some issues of borders, there are fights to be had. But they are far better addressed by being in the European community and arguing our case, not biting off our nose to spite our face. Yes, I will.
Elaine Smith.
Thank you for taking an intervention. I wonder what will happen if CETA and TTIP are passed at the European Union.
Mr. Cohen.
Again, there are divisions of opinion, and I think that the balance and where these arguments will eventually rest are yet to be decided. But actually, many of these international trade agreements are part of what the blocks of the trading partners in the world now actively participate in, and I think there are huge benefits to accrue from that. Now, I don't, in the balance of my time, want to repeat what I think is the litany of competing apocalyptic arguments on either side. All of these, or any of them, may be true, but I think they've become a blizzard and a distraction in this debate. I admit to an error of judgment. I actually thought that the Scottish referendum was a referendum that engaged both the head and the heart of people in this country, and that the arguments in this European referendum would be much more nuanced, they would be technical, they would be devoid of emotion. And yet, as the vote now approaches, I find that I care far more about the outcome than I actually ever thought I would. What sort of Britain do I actually want to live in? Do I want to have a sort of internationalist view or an isolationist view of our place in the world? Do I want to see us withdraw from our friends and markets? Do I want to see us unpick relationships which have been developing really very rapidly with the other nations after so short a time within the European community? In that, at least, I believe my arguments are consistent in relation to the two referendums. I do think there is sometimes an inconsistency in the nationalist argument. And I regret that we keep coming back to independence. To my astonishment, in this week's Radio Times, discover that Nicola Sturgeon is to star in a science fiction drama on Saturday, where she's going to be playing herself in John Wyndham's The Kraken Wakes. Now, in this drama, there has been an apocalypse. The world has been invaded by aliens. The polar ice caps have melted. Most of Britain is underwater, and Nicola Sturgeon will broadcast to the nation. And I've heard what she says. She says, this represents a material change in circumstances, and I therefore intend to... No, I came into politics to improve life for the generations that follow me. I do look to one of the architects of all of, one of the 11 founding members, Winston Churchill, who in 1942, at the height of the conflict, said, hard as it is to say now, I look forward to a Europe in which the barriers between nations will be greatly minimised and unrestricted travel will be possible, in which Britain will have to play her full part as a member of the European family. Do I look to Winston Churchill or do I look to Boris Johnson for my inspiration? I think I look to the former and not the latter. I'm going to be voting because I want to vote for a future that I think is the right one for my sons, for the grandchildren I hope yet to see. I realise that in doing that, there is a balance. There is a shift between centre-right and centre-left governments across Europe, and both have their part to play in the debate. It's not a case of saying, oh, I don't want any lefties having any say over what happens here, any more than it's for others to say, I don't want any of these right people having anything to do with it. There will be a balance over history as we move forward. I understand all of that, but ultimately, I want to be an internationalist, not an isolationist, and therefore I want to vote with all those others who wholeheartedly decide on June the 23rd that the right decision for this country is a vote to remain.
Thank you, Mr. Carlow. Can I encourage all members to make sure their cards are inserted? And I would ask all members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now, please. Can I call on Kezia Dugdale?
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome this chance to set out the positive case for the European Union. Labour is Scotland's internationalist party. We believe in solidarity beyond borders. We believe that sharing sovereignty makes us all stronger, wealthier, and safer. We believe in Scotland's place in the United Kingdom. Sovereignty shared is sovereignty gained. Walking alone in the world would not mean freedom, it would mean powerlessness. It is a truth that we understand in our own lives. We need each other because together, with others, life is so much more fulfilling. The vision of nations across the continent coming together has never been an easy one, but it has survived economic turmoil, the fall of communism, and expansion to welcome nation after nation. The changes we lived through together in the first 60 years of our European family, in the 43 years since we joined, is nothing compared to the upheaval that we are living through now. The shift of power and prosperity to the east, the spread of jihadism, growing inequality, a more confrontational Russia, climate change, conflict within nations, the refugee crisis, disillusion with democratic politics and the rise of the far right and anti-European parties who fill that void. This is a test for all of Europe, but all of Europe's eyes are currently on us. How will we react to the uncertainty of our world? Will we turn our back on our neighbours and turn in on ourselves, or will we face the world together? Will we be the outward-looking nation that made us so successful in the world, that took us into Europe in the first place, or will we retreat? This is a question all individuals and institutions will have to answer. And like all parties, there is a variety of views on Europe within Labour. And we'll hear a bit of the socialist case for Leave from my friend Elaine Smith later this morning. But in contrast to the civil war in the Tory cabinet, or the confusion of nationalists who argue that we can share sovereignty with every European nation except our nearest neighbours, Labour will campaign enthusiastically for our place in the European Union. This is a decision about where we believe the best future for the United Kingdom lies, in or out of Europe. The Leave campaign have attempted to make it a test of whether we believe in our country at all. They question our patriotism. Those of us who believe in sharing sovereignty with our neighbours defeated those arguments 2 years ago, but in doing so we learned a hard lesson, that populist arguments cannot be underestimated. So in this debate, the Remain side must win the arguments that appeal to the head, but we have also learned that it has to be combined with a story that reaches people's hearts. So we will make the economic case that the importance of trade within the EU is essential to Scottish jobs, worth nearly £12 billion, second only in value to trade within the rest of the United Kingdom. We will argue the case for workers' rights, that Europe guarantees basic standards at work for millions of Scottish workers and workers in other nations, regardless of who is in government. European guarantees like 4 weeks paid holiday for all, the equal treatment of part-time and full-time workers, the legal principle of equal pay for equal work, maternity leave, protection from discrimination due to age, race, gender, religion, disability, or sexual orientation. We will argue in a world of constant change and confusing new threats, we are more secure in bigger alliances than standing alone. We will argue that we can only tackle the threats to our environment by working together, that the weight of 28 nations working together enabled us to secure global action on climate change. We will argue this with reason, but also with passion. We will make all these arguments, but we will also argue that there is something beautiful about being part of this European family. It isn't found in the grey offices of officials in Brussels or in the columns of national balance sheets, but in the hundreds of millions of lives made more colourful, more fulfilling and exciting in the cities and towns of Scotland, the UK and the 27 other nations. My generation and that of my parents before me have become so used to being part of that Europe that we don't stop to wonder at the achievement that the EU represents. We cooperate across an entire continent, sharing freedom and opportunity together. That continent, whose history is written in conflict and chaos, is now defined by peace and by prosperity. The nations on the shores of the Mediterranean, the Baltic and the Black Sea, whose citizens lived under totalitarian regimes and military dictators, now take for granted their human rights, free speech and democracy itself. We have been a part of that. We built that. It's not perfect, of course it isn't, but it is as extraordinary an achievement as any in our history. We are a more European country for having built that union. We are richer for it. Not just the bump in our GDP, as important as that is, but richer for the shared experiences, the mixing of cultures, the people that we've come to know, the amazing experiences and opportunities that the EU has brought to us. And I fear we may not realise all of that until it's gone. So, Presiding Officer, I don't listen to those who say that Scotland is going to vote overwhelmingly to remain on the 23rd of June. There's no such thing as a guaranteed win in politics. And this is too important an argument to sit it out, too important for half-hearted support, too important not to lead. So for my part, I will make the case with everything I've got, the Labour case for Scotland and the UK in Europe. Thank you.
I thank Ms Dugdale. We now move to the open debate. I call on Richard Lockhead to be followed by Adam Tompkins. Mr Lockhead.
Can I begin by congratulating all the party leaders for showing leadership on Scotland and Europe and putting the case, the positive case for Remain. Can I also congratulate Fiona Hislop on her well-deserved reappointment to Cabinet, and also my other friend and colleague Alistair Allen on his new position in the Scottish Government as well. I'm sure you'll both wave the flag for Scotland on the international stage. Can I also say how much I look forward to representing my Moray constituents on these benches after a 9-year absence from these benches and contributing to the debates on the issues facing Scotland in the times ahead. Given that 50% of Scotch whisky is produced in Speyside and much of that goes to EU markets, and given that the water in the Water of Life is of supreme quality thanks to EU environmental legislation that applies to our rivers and our watercourses, and given how much Moray's famous food businesses such as Walker Shortbread and Baxter's export to EU markets, our access to the single market and the issues around EU membership is of direct relevance to thousands of families in Moray and the local economy. So we are debating today one of the biggest issues facing Scotland's future, our country's relationship with Europe, with the in-out referendum only weeks away. And the Scottish dimension of the EU referendum needs debated and broadcast widely, because there are many unique and distinctive issues for people in Scotland to consider before deciding how to vote on the 23rd of June. But this is about Europe's future, not just Scotland or the UK's. And the result of the vote on the 23rd will affect every single person in Scotland and across these islands, and potentially also every single one of Europe's 500 million citizens. And as someone that believes that Scotland should be a nation state in their own right, I strongly believe that Europe's nation states must work together and share and pool sovereignty where appropriate to meet the economic, social and environmental challenges of the 21st century. Just as many nations did in the 20th century to secure lasting peace and prosperity, it's indeed ironic that the UK, the country now holding this referendum, was instrumental in founding the United Nations in 1945 and then joined the European Community in 1973 in the first big expansion, in recognition that it can be in the national interest to share sovereignty. And it really, really saddens me that these high ideals have been crowded out in a referendum debate now dominated by immigration, especially when we consider the origins of the EU. Boris Johnson and his colleagues want to walk out of Europe, but they should knuckle down and help our fellow human beings in their hour of need. Indeed, another irony is actually that Boris Johnson recently published a biography of his hero, Winston Churchill, who at one point in 1940 proposed a Franco-British Union with shared currency and citizenship and joint economic and financial institutions. Now, of course, that was an idea put to Churchill to help win the war by one Jean Monnet, who went on to be a founding father of the European Union, to prevent another European war. So peace in Europe is the biggest dividend, but EU membership has resulted in many benefits for our citizens. When it comes to the workers' rights, their consumer protection, welfare, the environment, issues mentioned by Fiona Hislop and Kezia Dugdale, Scotland is much closer to the mainstream European social democracy position than the neoliberal politics of Boris Johnson and Nigel Farage, and the kind of Britain they want to see. And I have no doubt that most people in Scotland are much more supportive of the policies agreed by our progressive European partners and neighbours than some of the more regressive positions we've often seen adopted by Westminster. The negotiations, the compromises, the occasional climb downs that being a member of the club necessitates has often prevented UK ministers from actually imposing damaging policies on Scotland. I've come across in my time at European negotiations over 9 years of many examples where other EU member states actually shielded Scotland. Whether it was the £500 million for farm payments each year that continues to flow to Scotland because UK chancellors were outmanoeuvred and outvoted at EU negotiations, or I've got no time to take an intervention, apologies, or the considerable progressive social and economic legislation that I think we can all agree would never have seen the light of day had it been up to Whitehall. And the stark reality for Scotland is that transferring decision-making from Brussels to Whitehall, especially the UK Treasury, will often be against Scottish interests. And two further quick points. I've heard Brexit spokespeople, including the current UK Fisheries Minister, George Eustace, claim that Brexit will give Scottish ministers a greater role in issues such as fisheries. The difficulty for me is they could actually do that at the moment under the current arrangements, yeah. And they've chosen not to do that, and therefore their promises of what will happen post-Brexit absolutely ring hollow and should do for all our fishing communities. The final point I just want to make is, I've got 1 minute left, apologies. The final point I do want to make is that many people in Scotland do have genuine concerns about particular EU policies or how the EU institutions work or the direction that Europe is taking. And these are real, understandable, genuine concerns, and I'm sure many people across this chamber share some of these concerns. I know I do. The case for remaining in the EU is absolutely overwhelming, but our support for Remain must not mean we are unwilling to cast a critical eye towards the EU. I know from my experience in dealing with the EU institutions, it can take ages to fix damaging regulations. There's a need for more decentralisation, and we need more of a focus on the issues that matter to ordinary people in Europe. So in closing, further reform of the EU is absolutely necessary, but the best way forward for Scotland is to reform, not reject, the European Union. EU membership delivers benefits for Scotland, and I say, as Fiona Hislop said, it may be a forlorn hope, but in the remaining few weeks, I urge the campaigns to cut out the myths, the exaggerations and the scaremongering. And instead, can we have a debate based on vision, on facts and high ideals? Robert Schuman said in 1949, we are carrying out a great experiment, the fulfilment of the same recurrent dream that for 10 centuries has revisited the peoples of Europe, creating between them an organisation putting an end to war and guaranteeing an eternal peace. That is a high ideal I hope all of us in this chamber will support, and I hope that Scotland will support too on the 23rd of June.
Very good.
Thank you, Mr. Lockhead. I call Adam Tomkins to be followed by Christina McKelvey. Mr. Tomkins.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is a great honour to make my maiden speech in this Parliament as one of Glasgow's two newly elected Conservative MSPs. And given that I have taught European and British constitutional law at the University of Glasgow for the last 13 years, it is apt, I suppose, that I make my first speech in a debate on this United Kingdom's relationship with the European Union. And on the subject of the university, I refer members to my declaration of interests in the register. The city I represent, the city that is my home, where I got married and where my four children were born, has a proud European heritage. It was the first British city to be named European City of Culture in 1990. And a quarter of a century later, Glasgow is still making European waves, being ranked just this year as top large European city of the future. More than 5,000 EU students come to Glasgow each year to study in the city's three universities. And altogether, Glasgow's 130,000 students come from 135 countries around the world. It's no wonder that we are the Rough Guide's friendliest city on the planet. Presiding Officer, on the 23rd of June, I shall be voting to remain in the European Union. Not with the same passion and pride that I voted on the 18th of September 2014 to reject the SNP's proposition that we break up Britain, but with clarity nonetheless that to stay is the right course for Glasgow, for Scotland, for the UK, and indeed for the EU itself. In my judgment, the European Union is broken and needs fixing. With soaring unemployment in southern Europe, with a failed currency union, lessons here for Scotland too, immiserating the lives of millions of Europeans, and with a migration crisis the like of which the continent has not faced since the Second World War, the EU has problems aplenty. But the great failure of the Vote Leave campaign has been their complete inability to explain how our leaving the European Union would help to fix any of these problems. Just as I wanted Scotland to remain in the United Kingdom because that is in the UK's interests as well as in Scotland's, so too do I want the UK to remain in the EU because that is in the European public interest as well as in Britain's. We should remain precisely because the EU needs fixing. We Britons can lead the way in fixing it. The Prime Minister's renegotiation of the terms of Britain's membership of the European Union shows how this can be done. That renegotiation secured, not only for Britain, but for the whole of the European Union, that the single market will have conservative values at its core. It will be a more competitive single market, a better regulated single market, with fewer administrative burdens, lower compliance costs for business, and unnecessary European legislation repealed. Clipping the wings of the European Court of Justice is another of the Prime Minister's achievements that will certainly benefit Britain and will be to the advantage of the continent as a whole if others follow where British Conservatives have led. That the UK now has a much-needed opt-out from ever closer union will mean that in cases concerning the United Kingdom, at least, the European Court of Justice will have to enforce the law as member states have made it, rather than the law that the judges would like to see. And I, for one, fully share the frustration expressed recently by our own Supreme Court at the irresponsible overreach of some of the ECJ's case law. Presiding Officer, it was a Conservative government that took us into the European Economic Community in 1972. And it has been a Conservative government that has successfully and against the odds delivered a renegotiation of the UK's constitutional and legal relationship with the European Union now. A generation ago, yes, that's 41 years, a generation ago, the British people decided to remain in the EEC. We should reaffirm that decision next month, not because the European Union is perfect, but because its problems, like our own domestic challenges, require British Conservative solutions. Solutions that get government off people's backs and leave them free to pursue their lives. Solutions that encourage free movement of goods, of services, and yes, of workers too. Solutions designed to ensure not only the redistribution of wealth, but the very creation of wealth in the first place. For these are the values of union. Economic prosperity and security for all lay at the heart of our case for a no vote in 2014, as they lie now at the core of the case for a Remain vote next month. These are my values. These are the values of my party. These are the values that have brought me into Scottish politics, and these are the values of economic prosperity and security for all that I shall seek to promote in the interests of Glasgow and Scotland as a whole every day as a member of this Parliament. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tompkins, and thank you too for speaking precisely to time. Just remind members, there's an expectation that every member who wants to speak will be able to get in this debate. Well, we are aiming for speeches of around 5 minutes. I call Christina McKelvey, followed by Daniel Johnson. Christina McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I can welcome you to your new place in the chair. Presiding Officer, there's much about this EU debate that reminds me of Alice Through the Looking Glass by Lewis Carroll. What's up is down, what's in is out. Two right-wing factions of one party fighting over who's more Eurosceptic. So it reminds me a bit of Alice at the crossroads, or shall we say Boris at the crossroads. Would you tell me which way I ought to go from here, asked Boris. Well, that depends a great deal on where you want to get, said the cat. The cat's name was Nigel. I really don't care, replied Boris. Then it doesn't much matter which way you go, said Nigel, the cat. But it does matter, and it matters a whole lot to all of us here today. Then we have the Prime Minister asking us a question not based on the flimsy deal he secured at the December Council of Ministers. We have a question on the 23rd of June based on a false premise. Do you agree with the reforms? The flimsy reforms I have secured would be a much more honest question. Presiding Officer, on the radio this morning I heard that the children's word of the year is refugee. Imprinted on the mind of our young folk as a humanitarian disaster not seen since the Second World War, and our young people want action. So from the mouth of babes, we hear much wisdom. And earlier this year, I hosted in this place an event with the Scottish European Educational Trust. The Our Europe premiere and awards ceremony took place in this Parliament, and it was a huge success, with teams from all over Scotland of young people who made films on what the EU meant from then. And I would urge all of my colleagues to take the time to watch these films. Their films were very enlightening indeed, and they spoke of peace, of rights, of rebuilding Europe, of creating opportunity, and of democracy. And that leads me to think of some of the great things that I think the EU has produced. Workers' rights, Presiding Officer, as you know, is something very, very close to my heart. And here are some, and my thanks to the TUC for such a clear detail. I think we spoke enough last night, Mr. Finlay. In the UK, employees do not have the right to a written contract. Maybe you should learn something. Maybe you should sit and learn something. In the UK, employees do not have the right to a written contract of employment. You know, rudeness doesn't get you anywhere. But thanks to the EU Written Statement Directive, employees must be given a written statement settling out those pay and working conditions within 28 days of starting work. What about the Working Time Directive? That was implemented in the UK in 1998. It introduced a maximum 48-hour week, normally averaged over 17 weeks, a daily rest period and 11 consecutive hours, a weekly rest period of 24 consecutive hours, and rest breaks during the working day. These are the regulations that some Tories would like to take away from people. Or let's move on to maternity rights. The EU Pregnant Workers Directive of 1992 led to substantial improvements in the health and safety protections for expecting and new mothers in the workplace. And let's just look at equal pay. There's been a lot of misinformation out there on equal pay. The right to equal pay was indeed formulated in the UK. It was the equal work between men and women, and it made it a fundamental right. This is enshrined in the EU Treaty, now Article 157, which is directly enforceable in the UK. It was in the founding treaty of the EEC to prevent those member states with equal pay legislation from being undercut by others who underpaid and exploited the weaker labour market positions of women workers. And Article 157, together with the Equal Pay Directive and case law of the ECJ, have led to a significant positive impact on women's pay and pensions rights in the UK. The Equal Pay Act of 1970 predated the UK joining the EU, I know that. But the original Act had a glaring omission because it did not cover equal pay for equal value. And that's where the difference lies. And let's just look at discrimination. The UK already had sex and race discrimination laws in place when it joined the EU. Yes, it did. It introduced a Disability Discrimination Act prior to the EU taking action. However, legislation on age, religion and belief and sexual orientation discrimination was introduced as a direct result of the EU Framework and Equal Treatment Directive of 2000. And let's not even start on human rights, because human rights is something that we should all agree on. The European Convention of Human Rights and this charter, the charter that reaffirms our collective rights in this place and time. Presiding officer, as we've heard, there's a lot of things that we need to be proud of in being a member of the EU. Now, my question to you is, do we vote to leave and give a UK government carte blanche to withdraw all of these rights? A UK government unfettered by these regulations, because when they talk about regulations, these are the rights that they mean? Or do we vote to remain and fight to reform and create the Europe that our young people want? So, presiding officer, I say we, tack, ya, and see to remain.
Thank you, Mr. Kelvey. I call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Ross Greer. Mr. Johnson.
Presiding officer, can I start by saying what a privilege it is to be called for the first time as the new member for Edinburgh Southern in this parliament. A privilege that comes with a sense of duty and responsibility to my constituents to make sure that I deliver on their priorities. And there could be no better debate than this one to make my maiden speech, because Edinburgh Southern regularly polls as one of the most pro-EU areas, not just in Scotland, but the whole of the UK. And from the many doorstep conversations I had during the election, I can attest to that. But before I make any further progress, I would just like to acknowledge and pay thanks to the work and dedicated service of my predecessor, Jim Eadie. It is a tribute to him, not just the warm words that have been consistently said about him from across the chamber, but that many of those warmest words have come from fellow Labour members. A tribute indeed, given that this lot have stopped saying nice things about me after about 5 minutes, let alone 5 years. Edinburgh Southern is a diverse constituency, a network of communities. It's an area of contrasts. On its northern boundary, we have Fountain Bridge, a site that once sustained jobs in the brewing industry, but is now one of the city's largest gap sites. Edinburgh Southern is also an area of leafy suburbs, sustained by high quality, professional, high productivity jobs. So Europe matters to my constituency because whether it is investing for future jobs or sustaining existing strengths, our membership of the European Union is vital. And for the avoidance of doubt, this Johnson is definitely more Alan than Boris. Presiding officer, we need to change the terms and tenor of the debate on Europe. To date, the focus has been on personality and overblown rhetoric. Both sides talk in telephone number statistics and a race to who can claim the biggest financial calamity if the other side wins. It is not good enough. There is a reason why my constituency is one of the most pro-Europe. Because it's real. We have the King's Buildings in the middle of Edinburgh Southern, a hub for science in Edinburgh University. It alone provides a multitude of reasons why Europe is a positive force. Universities are institutions with a global perspective. In academia, collaboration is what builds better learning and better research. Edinburgh University alone receives £45 million a year in research funding from the EU. Universities gain strength from their diverse student communities. And at Edinburgh, there's 4,500 non-UK EU students, and over 1,000 Edinburgh students participate in the Erasmus programme every year. So for them, the opportunities of Europe are clear and concrete. This is our responsibility in the debate, to make it real, to point out the benefits of European cooperation and integration. It's too easy for those benefits to be taken for granted and dismissed. And the benefits and opportunities are not confined to academe. Representing an Edinburgh constituency, I'm all too aware of the importance of the financial services sector. We have 100,000 people employed directly by financial services in Scotland, with another 100,000 in supporting roles. And it's a major centre of asset management in Europe. This activity, these jobs, rely on Europe. So-called passporting enables our skills and our expertise to be applied across the borders of Europe. Our service sector has become fundamental to our export drive, and our financial services expertise is at the core of this. On top of trade, Brexiteers snort that the Germans will still want to buy VWs, and they will sell us VWs and continue to buy Dyson vacuum cleaners. But in reality, the export of services is far more important. And they are far more liable to get snarled up in cross-border regulation. And with justification, it is important that cross-border financial activity is controlled and regulated. But by ripping us out of Europe, we are putting thousands of jobs at risk in what is indisputably one of Scotland's vital industries. In Europe, we enjoy better working conditions, better public services. We are more productive, we have higher standards of living than anywhere else in the world. Through the European Work Time Directive and the standards set out in the social chapter, we enhance and guarantee working conditions. And it's not just that they create those standards here, but they are strengthened by being consistent across the continent, by acting collectively. While we need to make Europe real, we also need to make the debate bigger. We are living in an increasingly globalised world. The ability to move products across the world puts huge pressure on wages and working conditions. The argument from these Labour benches for Europe, I think, is obvious. By working together, we achieve more. Through cooperation and collective interest, we are stronger. These are ideas embedded in the Labour movement. They are also the ideas that underpin Europe. In a time of ever-increasing globalisation, we have a choice: to try to compete in an unwinnable race to the bottom, or to work with others for mutual benefit. Today, we are faced with issues that are truly global in scale. Climate change poses a massive threat to our way of life. The global financial crash is still with us, almost 10 years on. The Middle East crisis has triggered the biggest movement of refugees since World War II. These are the issues of our time. And the only way to tackle them is together, to contemplate withdrawing from the EU. The most effective supranational institution we have is quite simply a move in the wrong direction. Isolation makes it harder to deal with these issues. We achieve more by removing borders and frontiers than we ever can by putting them in place. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I call Ross Greer to be followed by Michael Russell. Mr. Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is my first speech as a member of this Parliament, but it is not my first speech in this chamber. Uniquely amongst the Parliaments and Assemblies in these islands, this Parliament regularly opens itself up to wider Scottish society, an opportunity that I had as a school student a few years ago. Members will be reassured, though, that I will not be passing judgment on whether the standard of debate was higher with 16-year-old school students than with those present in the chamber today. Whilst my time at school was not too many years ago, and to many I seem to be known only as the youngest member of this Parliament, the other record I broke is the one that I'm prouder of. I'm the first Green MSP for the West of Scotland, and I cannot thank enough the volunteers and voters who made that possible. We promised to make this Parliament bolder, and that is exactly what the Green MSPs intend on doing. More pressing, though, is the referendum, not one of our choosing, but whose result will have a profound effect on Scotland. At UK level, this referendum debate has been nothing more than a contest between two different wings of the Conservative Party, two different flavours of a failed economic model, two different kinds of hostility to immigrants and refugees. They expect us to choose between an isolated, inward-looking UK or a Europe of the corporations and the bankers. In that debate, it's no surprise that many progressives are tempted to vote to leave, even if I respectfully disagree with those on the left who will ultimately decide to do so. But those of us who believe in a progressive Europe, a people's Europe, must stand up for everything we have already won. We must explain what this is truly a choice between. Europe has strengthened workers' rights, as Fiona Hislop mentioned in her opening remarks. The Working Time Directive means that workers across the continent are protected from overwork and guaranteed adequate time off. When you look at those leading the Leave campaign, you can understand why the trade union movement is, on the whole, campaigning so vigorously to stay in. As a trade unionist myself, I have no desire to give Westminster unrestricted ability to decimate our workers' rights. Europe has brought limited but welcome regulation in the financial sector as well. Green MEP Philippe Lambert is known by the Financial Times as the man who beat the banks for successfully introducing a cap on bankers' bonuses. This is just one of the efforts, small efforts, which have been made to rein in the financial sector at European level. It is the kind of progress which can only be made at European level and not by the individual action of member states. And Europe has brought huge benefit to our environment. It was European regulation which forced the UK government to eliminate acid rain and smog. It was European regulation which stopped the dumping of raw sewage into our oceans and made our beaches cleaner, safer, and more attractive. And it is European regulation which makes our air more breathable and less polluted. So what exactly, presiding officer, is the red tape opponents of the European Union talk of? Is it all of the above? Is it the health and safety legislation, which has seen workplace deaths reduced by 2/3 in 2 decades? Is it the limited attempts to bring the bankers to heel? Is it the legislation which has made our air breathable, protects our wildlife, and keeps our beaches clean? That is exactly the kind of red tape they're talking about, and it is only a fraction of what the EU has brought us. But the hardest argument to explain in this debate is the one that is probably the most important, as has been brought up already. European cooperation has brought us decades of uninterrupted peace, unprecedented in Western Europe, and it is exactly why only this week the Church of Scotland reaffirmed its commitment to Scotland and the United Kingdom staying in the European Union. Members may have noticed that I'm a bit younger than the average MSP. Given this reputation, and that it will not be leaving me for some time, I asked a number of other young people what they would contribute to the debate if given the chance. And there was one response that really stuck out. Europe provides young people with endless opportunities to connect with and learn from others. Its diversity and cooperation is something we need to celebrate. Everything from Erasmus to the freedom of movement means Europe is somewhere for young people to explore, learn, and find employment. Leaving would limit us politically and economically, but it would limit us socially as well. It is worth noting, presiding officer, that the Scottish Youth Parliament found an overwhelming majority of young people in favour of remaining in the European Union. And I should declare an interest as a former member of that Youth Parliament, but this is a generation with no interest in isolating themselves. Whilst it is deeply flawed, whilst it requires major reforms, both democratic and economic, it is our European Union, and reform can and does happen. The Greens are under no illusions about the lack of reforms that we have demanded, but we have made progress. The European Parliament is more powerful than it ever has been before. And there's so much more still to come. It's Green MEPs who have led the fight against secretive and dangerous trade deals such as TTIP. But I'd be interested to hear from members intending on voting to leave how they think the UK's unilateral trade deals would be any different. And this is the debate that we should be having. Not between the Conservatives' vision for Europe and the Conservatives' vision for Britain, but between their vision and the vision of a people's Europe that we can build together by staying in.
Thank you, Mr. Greer. I call Michael Russell to be followed by Margaret Mitchell. Mr. Russell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I say what a pleasure and an honour it is to speak after the first speech of Ross Greer? I am not the oldest member, fortuitously, but all older members will be stretched and tested by the changed nature of this chamber. I would say to Ross Greer, however, that 40 years ago, I voted in the first European referendum at almost exactly his age, and I rebelled against my party. I voted yes when the SNP leadership voted no. I am relieved to be more in tune with the mainstream of my party now after 40 years, because I wholeheartedly support the Remain campaign. But there was consistency in my and the SNP's inconsistency. The decision to recommend a no vote in 1975 was based upon an assertion of Scottish sovereignty, which in that case refused to accept terms negotiated by a UK government without reference to Scotland. And amongst those terms was the abandonment of the Scottish fishing industry, which was seen as expendable. And communities which I represent have paid a price for that every single year since. Once again, the SNP is asserting our sovereignty, this time by making a positive case for Europe, a case rooted in our desire to be an independent member as befits an ancient nation. And we assert our sovereignty not only by making that case, but also by refusing to be dragged out on the coattails of an increasingly raucous and isolationist campaign against membership. Our case is rooted in Scotland's positive pro-European history, joint citizenship with France in the 16th century, attendance of Scottish students at universities across the continent, something I was very pleased to encourage when I was Education Secretary, and an earlier our appeal for nationhood being made and heeded in Rome. And our attitude is also rooted in the present, in the work of people like a former member of this chamber, Madame Ecosse herself, Scotland's longest-serving European MP and a passionate advocate of the European Union. And her belief in Europe, first of all, was born out of her circumstances as a woman born in 1929, only a decade after the end of a world war that had its origins on the continent. And living through another as a young woman, she knew that a legally based, inclusive, irreversible collaborative structure was the thing that would guarantee peace in Europe. It was essential. It was essential to her as it was essential to my own father, who carried shrapnel in his leg from the beach at Dunkirk. That's not an aspect of Europe to be sneered at or ignored. It has saved lives. It has stopped lives and families being ruined. And it saved humans from suffering too. The underpinning principles of European collaboration are designed to protect the rights of citizens fundamentally from attack upon them, which was genocide. I find it astonishing that anybody could argue to remove the European Convention of Human Rights, given its origins. Now, the European Union is not, however, like the union we live in on this island, an incorporating union. We cannot express our sovereignty within this union because it's been removed. Indeed, our very view of sovereignty, lying with the people, not in the Parliament, has been usurped. But in the EU, sovereignty is freely pooled for shared advantage. There is participation as equals in decision-making. And that's the type of union that benefits independent states and benefits all those who live in them. And the EU also invites others to share and benefit from its existence. Although Winnie Ewing is mostly remembered in the Highlands and Islands for speaking up for the area and introducing Objective One assistance that resulted in a great boost to the infrastructure, it's her achievement in securing the hosting of the Lome Convention in Inverness in 1985 that is best remembered out with Europe. She still believes, I know, that encouraging other states to recognize that Scotland still aspires to full statehood, wants to enter into the family of nations, positively enhances our prospects and our success as a nation. She famously wanted the slogan from her Hamilton by-election in 1967, to stop the world because Scotland wants to get on. We still want to get on. We need to aspire to be co-decision makers. And it's Europe that provides the context for that. Indeed, there can be no other relevant context. As Jim Sillars eloquently showed a generation ago with his enthusiasm for independence in Europe, which I, at least, still espouse. Where Europe falls short, it's the open, democratic nature of Europe that can pick up, criticise and analyse those faults and find ways to do better. Isolationism can never do that. I rejoice, Presiding Officer, in the fact that our European cooperation is founded on a shared history. It's grounded in the desire for peace and justice, It's surrounded by cultural, environmental, social and economic ambition, and it's rounded off by a generous vision of our obligations to fellow human beings and to the world. And I rejoice that that cooperation reflects my own, and I believe my party's vision, of how an independent Scotland would and will work with others when that time comes. To choose to remain is to choose the positive, to choose to carry on investing with our resources and hard work in a better future. It's a clear and easy choice. In fact, for those who want to see an independent Scotland emerge into the family of nations, there is no choice at all.
Thank you very much, Mr. Russell. I call Margaret Mitchell to be followed by Alec Cole-Hamilton. Mrs. Mitchell.
Deputy Presiding Officer, Scotland elects four tiers of government. The one the public knows least about is the European level, with most people struggling to name how many MEPs are returned from Scotland, let alone the names of these MEPs or what they actually do in Brussels. Unsurprisingly, therefore, so many people either couldn't care less about this referendum or consider that the issues at stake are ones that they know little about. In this debate of 2.5 hours, we have leave speeches, which are 10 minutes, and with the grace of the Deputy Presiding Officer, perhaps 12. The member will forgive me, therefore, on this occasion, if I don't take an intervention. Adding to the confusion, and despite her vow that the 2014 separation referendum would be a once-in-a-lifetime event, the First Minister, asserting as usual that she speaks for all of Scotland, assumes Scotland will vote Remain. And if the rest of the UK votes Leave, this, she says, will justify another separation referendum. Ironically, therefore, she is sending out a clear and unambiguous message to all those in Scotland who voted against separation or who are sick to death of talk of a second referendum. To avoid this, they should vote Leave. However, each individual will make up their own mind how to vote. For my part, I don't pretend to have all the answers, nor am I a member of any official Leave campaign. But having looked at the arguments, my reasons to vote Leave are as follows, starting with the economic argument and the EU itself. From 1980 to 2015, the EU's share of world economic output has dropped from 30% to 17%. At the end of 2015, the EU's share of world trade was the same as it was in 2006. In the meantime, every other continent in the world has grown over the past 10 years. Only 5% of British business and less than 10% of Scottish business export to the EU. But family and small, medium-sized enterprises and other business are stifled by the burden of EU regulation. This in turn damages our economy, costing small businesses millions every week. Worse still, despite being the world's fifth largest economy, as a member of the EU club, Britain cannot sign independent trade deals with emerging markets. Given this, it's impossible not to conclude, and remember, Britain joined a European economic community for trading reasons, that the EU is a failing and outdated institution. A vote to leave restores the freedom to trade with the rest of the world, and logically, as the EU exports more to the UK than we do to the EU, there are tremendous advantages for the EU still continuing to trade with the UK. However, the key argument for voting to leave goes far beyond the economic one and centres around the free movement of people. The European Union's other 27 member states together have a population of 500 million. The UK has a population of 65 million. With an ageing population, we need more migration, but the free movement of people means we can't choose those with the skills we need to grow our economy. Instead, anyone from this 500 million population can come and live in the UK. And whilst I understand why people from other parts of the EU would want to come here to improve their standard of living, this has the potential to put unsustainable pressure, no thank you, on our schools, health service, housing, etc., with translation costs alone already impacting on public services. and the access these economic migrants gain to our benefit system in turn impacts adversely on pensions and other benefits which UK citizens have worked, in some cases, a lifetime to secure. Furthermore, the UK pays more into the EU than we get out, including our rebate. This equates to a net £24 million per day. As a sovereign parliament, this amount could and should be used to determine our own policies, including policies that affect our fishing industry and the communities it supports right across Scotland and beyond, where these communities will continue to suffer economic hardship as long as we are under the control of the EU's common fisheries policy, the EU common agricultural policy, short changes UK farmers compared to their competitors. In 2014, we gave £4.6 billion to CAP, yet our farmers received £2.9 billion back. Additionally, the PM has confirmed if we vote leave, the UK government will ensure farmers continue to receive as much support as they do now. Finally,
can I ask the member to wind up? Thank you.
Finally, it's not the EU which has kept the peace for the last 4 years, but NATO. It sorted out Bosnia. Bilateral treaties and agreements already exist with countries that are not part of the EU for justice and defence. Quite simply, it's in the interest of the EU countries to cooperate and share information to combat terrorism and to extradite criminals. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, it's impossible for anyone to predict with any certainty what the future will hold, whether we are in and out the EU. But we are a talented and innovative people with financial institutions respected worldwide.
No, the member must wind up,
please. And as the United Kingdom, we are a force to be reckoned with. We should grasp the opportunity to realise this potential and vote leave.
Thank you very much. I gave you a little longer because there are so few speaking against. Can I call Alec Cole-Hamilton, please, followed by Claire Adamson. Mr. Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I rise to deliver my first speech to the Scottish Parliament, and I feel that sense of awe that I have seen on the faces of my fellow newcomers to this place, who have given excellent speeches both yesterday and this morning. My journey to this chamber has been a very long one, and I am very grateful for the kindness of parliamentary staff, of journalists, and indeed members of all parties for the goodwill they have shown me in these first weeks. Goodwill tinged with surprise, I might have had it, my appearance here. But that surprise eclipsed by my own when I was plucked from the ranks of new Liberal Democrat MSPs and immediately promoted to the front bench. That was something of a shock. Before I address the substance of this debate, I'd like to pay tribute to my immediate predecessor, Colin Keir, who was a kind and generous man, and I wish him every success in his future. I'd also like to pay tribute to the last Liberal parliamentarian to represent Edinburgh Western, Margaret Smith. Margaret served this chamber for 12 years and delivered many of the changes that brought about free personal care for the elderly. All of us can attest to the honour it is to represent the great communities of West Edinburgh, steeped in history that goes back to Roman times and flanking the beautiful fringes of the Forth Estuary in the shadow of our own World Heritage Site, the Forth Rail Bridge. And I'm sorry to say that following my election, an area that is no longer available to the SNP for parliamentary group photographs. I am sorry about that. But we come together to... my first act as a parliamentarian for Edinburgh Western is to make the case why my constituents and your constituents are demonstrably better off as part of the European Union. 100 years ago, almost to the day, my great-granduncle, a private in the 1st Canadian Mounted Rifles out of Saskatchewan, at the age of 23, was killed along with 80% of his battalion on the first day of the Battle of Montserrat on the Ypres salient. His name was Alexander Bennett, and I am named for him. Just a generation later, his sacrifice was met by that of two of my grandfather's four siblings, killed on active service, this time in World War II. And I think it a measure, Presiding Officer, of the success of this European project, that I am only the second generation in the recorded history of my entire family to never have to contemplate taking up arms against our nearest European neighbours. It is a comfort that I would extend to my three children, Finn, Kit, and Darcy, and theirs to come. because it is from that shared desire for a continued and lasting peace that the originating treaties of European Union first emerged, from the coal and steel community in 51, so that no country could ever again build a war machine, and then the Treaty of Rome, which led to a single market in which the free movement of goods, people, capital, and services have come to represent the most important charter for freedom that this world has ever seen. It is a solidarity of nations that has become a family. Now, the Brexiteers and Margaret Mitchell and her colleagues would have you paint a very nice picture of what it would be to reclaim all of our sovereignty. But it is a doctrine of isolationism, pure and simple. And I would put it to you, Presiding Officer, that in this increasingly globalized world, that human traffickers will never recognize that isolation. Climate change will never recognize that isolation. And nor will terrorists. Terrorists will never recognize that isolation. So if we were to leave, then we would be a tiny archipelago of islands adrift in a sea of economic uncertainty. That is why the Liberal Democrat benches are so proudly, full-throatedly backing the Remain campaign. And I am delighted, I am heartily glad that my first speech in this place is one of such consensus, where I find myself on common ground, not just with opposition parties, but with the government benches as well. And I hope there are many days like this to come in my parliamentary service. Because with consensus, this place can move mountains, and it has done. Working in the children's sector from outside this chamber, I helped to broker a consensus which changed the age of leaving care and will change lives as a result of it. But there will be days of discord as well. And that's good, that's right, because John F. Kennedy said that without criticism and without debate, no administration can succeed and no republic can survive. And it is incumbent upon opposition parties, particularly in a minority government situation, to challenge and to scrutinize. So I will offer that debate. I will offer that scrutiny. And it will at times be fierce, it will always be reasoned, and it will always, always be liberal. But today, let's put aside those differences and embrace that common ground on which we find ourselves, that sense of real optimism currently sweeping the Liberal Democrats, and I know sweeping other parties as well, because we have so much to gain by remaining as members of this European Union. We must gather together and vigorously campaign for a Remain vote on June the 23rd. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Clare Adamson to be followed by Mary Fee. Ms. Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is by no means my first speech in the Chamber, but it is my debut speech as a constituency member for Motherwell and Wishaw. I would like to pay tribute to my predecessor, John Pentland, who served as an MSP in Session 4. I've known Mr. Pentland for many years, having shared a council ward with him before we were both elected to the Parliament in 2011. And although political sparring partners in that time, we've always had a very amiable relationship. And I know he's still is a passionate campaigner for his community, and I wish him well in the future and for his family. I would also like to thank the constituents of Motherwell and Wishaw for putting their faith in me to be a strong voice for them in this Parliament. And I'm very, very honoured to speak today when so many new members of the Parliament have made their maiden speeches, Mr. Cole Hamilton, Mr. Tompkins, Mr. Johnson, Mr. Greer, and more to come today. Presiding Officer, there are many elements, and some of them have been discussed today already, about the European Union. Many of them are about the big issues, the big idea of Europe, about that collaboration, that movement for peace and for unity across Europe. But I'd like to highlight, if possible, the minutiae of one benefit that the EU brings to us today in Scotland, and that's to highlight the Horizon 2020 innovation programme within Europe. This makes available £80 billion of euros to fund research and innovation across the European Union. It encourages breakthroughs, discoveries, first-class scientific developments and laboratory innovations. And more importantly, it encourages collaboration across the whole of Europe. This is about global competitiveness. It is about making the European Union a driving force for economic growth, one that creates jobs. And this project has the political backing from across Europe and all members of the European Parliament. It is a blueprint for Europe. It puts sustainable and inclusive growth for jobs at the heart of where we put our research and investment in this area. We want world-class science. We want to remove barriers for innovation and make it easier for public and private sectors to work together and deliver innovation and growth. The EU Framework Programme for Research and Innovation is also complemented by collaboration across these areas, breaking down barriers and creating a genuine market for knowledge, research and innovation. There are key areas in which this focuses on: excellence in science, industrial leadership and societal challenges. And if I could just concentrate slightly on societal challenges, this is about helping tackle the major issues that all European nations face: climate change, sustainable transport, mobility, making renewable energies more affordable, ensuring food safety and security, and coping with the challenge of an ageing population. I think all of those issues were raised in the debate yesterday about what's at heart across the chamber of putting Scotland forward. Because Scotland's priorities are Europe's priorities, and we can only achieve those priorities by continuing to work together in the European context. Health and demographic change was mentioned by Nicola Sturgeon. Food security has been mentioned today. Secure, clean and efficient energy, mentioned by Ruth Davidson and Graeme Day yesterday. Smart, green, integrated transport, key to Patrick Harvey's speech. And in his excellent maiden speech, Moira Golden concentrated on climate change. These are at the very heart of where we want to be as a nation. But importantly as well, secure societies, protecting freedoms and the security of European citizens. As Kezia Dugdale mentioned today, it's about human rights, it's about trade union rights, those rights that Westminster would seek to take away from us. I would like to finish by a very tangible example of what Horizon 2020 brings to Scotland. Last October, the Centre for Research in Education, Inclusion and Diversity was awarded a grant from the Horizon 2020 programme that will allow a 3-year project encouraging lifelong learning for an inclusive and vibrant Europe. It's part of a European consortium that involves England, Flanders, Austria, Denmark, Slovakia, Bulgaria, Estonia and Spain, and it will explore policy interventions in adult education with a focus on training young adults. That's at the heart of what this government wants to do in education. We are at the heart of Europe and should stay there.
Thank you very much. I call Mary Fee, to be followed by Tom Arthur. Ms. Fee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've heard some interesting and insightful contributions so far this morning from across the Chamber in relation to the upcoming referendum on Britain's membership within the EU. And I'd particularly like to welcome the excellent contributions from our new members today. I am unambiguous and unapologetic in my support of Britain's continued membership of the EU. For me, the argument in favour of Britain staying as a member of the EU is rooted in my personal beliefs and values, which are beliefs and values that are shared by the Scottish Labour Party, of cooperation, solidarity and equality. Fundamentally, I believe in the maxim that by the strength of our common endeavour, we achieve more than we achieve alone. And my first substantive argument is that working women in Scotland and across the UK are better off with Britain remaining in the EU. The facts are clear and the arguments are compelling. The TUC produced a comprehensive report this year which spotlighted 20 ways in which women workers have explicitly benefited from Britain's membership of the EU. For example, the report highlights that although the British Equal Pay Act was introduced in 1970 in response to the action taken by women working at the Ford factory in Dagenham, in their fight for equal pay, this Act did not actually give women the right to equal pay for work of equal value. It was, in fact, EU law that ensured that working women in Britain received the right to equal pay for work of equal value. The Equal Pay Directive, adopted by the EU in 1975, made clear that the right to equal pay meant that women would receive equal pay for work of equal value. The European Union has delivered for women in the past and continues to promote cooperation, solidarity and equality for working women all across Europe. For women in Scotland and across the UK, the EU has secured equal pensions for part-time women workers, better protection from sexual harassment, paid time off for antenatal care, better health and safety protection for pregnant workers, and better protection from unfair dismissal because of pregnancy. Britain's continued membership of the EU is in the interests of working women across Scotland and the UK. And I would urge all working women in Scotland to make a passionate, positive and progressive case for remaining within the EU in order to defend the protections that our membership of the EU has given us. And the second substantive argument I'd like to develop is that whether people like it or not, there is an inherent risk to leaving the EU. The evidence has shown that one of the main risks of leaving is more austerity. And as members across this chamber will be aware, austerity disproportionately affects women. And this is not a risk I am willing to take. This week, the IFS has warned that if Britain votes to leave the EU, it could result in public finances being reduced by around 20 billion. Last year, A Fair Deal for Women, an umbrella group consisting of 11 women's rights charities, such as Women's Aid, the Fawcett Society, and Rape Crisis, highlighted that in 2015, Britain fell to 26th place on the World Economic Forum's Gender Gap Index, lower than almost all of its European neighbours. And A Fair Deal for Women was clear in its assertion that women have been disproportionately affected by the austerity agenda. The group spokesperson, Florence Burton, stated that austerity further cements women's poverty. Women simply cannot afford for austerity cuts to get any deeper or to continue any longer. There is nothing progressive. No, I do apologise, but my time has been cut today, so I'm really sorry. There is nothing progressive about continuing austerity. If we wish to tackle gender inequality and have a progressive economy that invests in people and invests in our public services, then it's vital that we stay within the EU. I would also briefly like to touch on the European Convention of Human Rights before coming to a close. The ECHR was drafted in the aftermath of World War II and is symbolic of the visionary and progressive ideals of progressive post-war Europe. The ECHR protects everyone's human rights, young and old, rich and poor, male and female. The ECHR is at the progressive core of what makes Europe a force for positive change in the world, and its importance should never be underestimated. We as women have to start making the passionate, positive and progressive case for Britain's continued membership of the EU through promoting the shared values of the Labour Party, the EU, of cooperation, of solidarity and of equality. And it is now time for women in Scotland to take centre stage in this debate. It's time to put women's issues and women's voices at the forefront of this debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Tom Arthur to be followed by Graham Simpson. Mr. Arthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, may I offer my congratulations to both you and your fellow Presiding Officers on your election to your new positions, and may I wish you all the very best in your new roles.
You've made a brilliant start.
I listen and learn. For me, as the newly elected member of Renfrewshire South, it is an honour and a privilege to have the opportunity to participate in this important debate in this, our national parliament. Before addressing the signal question of Scotland and the United Kingdom's relationship with the European Union, I would like to say a few words about my predecessor, Hugh Henry, and the constituency I am now proud to represent. In a career spanning over three decades, Hugh served his party, his community, his constituency, and his country with distinction. As a councillor, council leader, MSP, minister, shadow minister, committee convener, and former politician of the year, Hugh Henry leaves a formidable legacy, and I wish you and his family the very best for a long and healthy retirement. The constituency of Renfrewshire South encompasses the proud and diverse communities of southern and western Renfrewshire. Several of these towns and villages are of some renown and fame. Kilbarkin, well known today for its restored weaver's cottage, was in 1875 the birthplace of Mary Rough. From Kilbarkin, the Rough family moved to Elderslie, also in my constituency, where Mary, at Wallace Place, would marry David Barber of Johnston, assuming the name we all know her by today. Over a century later, the ideals of two of Renfrewshire's most famous children would be as one in a union of progressive politics and the idea of an independent Scotland. My constituency is also home to Lynwood, in which, from the ashes of a deindustrialisation inflicted from afar, is emerging a centre of community-led regeneration. Last week, I had the pleasure of meeting with the Lynwood Community Development Trust, brought into being and driven forward by a group of local women whose drive and determination is only matched by their ambition for their community. Lynwood is, in some respects, a microcosm of Scotland, an empowered and engaged community coming together to shape their collective future. In the months and years ahead, I look forward to sharing with this chamber the many stories from the many communities of Renfrewshire South. I look forward to working towards creating a fairer and more prosperous Renfrewshire South, just as we are all united in this place and working together to creating a fairer and more prosperous Scotland. But for a fair and prosperous Scotland, indeed, for a fair and prosperous United Kingdom, we must not turn our backs on our European partners. There have been, and I'm sure there will be further, erudite and considered contributions to this debate that will present and articulate many economic, fiscal, and social justifications for remaining in the European Union. However, with the time I have remaining and speaking as a new and young, well, he's left his place now, not that young, MSP, I'd like to convey a sense of what the European means to me personally, and I think also to many people of my generation. My earliest memory of any political event is of the TV news reports from Berlin in November 1989. As a wee boy watching the television, I didn't, of course, understand the context or historical significance of what I was seeing. What I do remember is the sense that the events unfolding were important, and I recall recognising in a sense of shared humanity the hope and joy etched on the faces of those surmounting and tearing down that wall. I share this experience with the Chamber because in its simplicity, innocence, and humanity, it recognises what I think is most fundamental in this debate. The European Union cannot be reduced to a set of trade deals and diplomatic arrangements. What began as a means to ensure that French and German coal reserves could never again be used as capital in war making is now the most successful community of independent nation states ever to be assembled. It is testimony to this success that so many nations have aspired and continue to aspire to membership. To be a citizen of the European Union is to be one of 500 million people who each have a stake in this great project that gives expression to our ancient shared identity as Europeans. And it is now for us, with our multi-layered identities as Scots, Brits, Europeans, and as citizens of the EU, that we must make a choice. Will we recommit to that shared project of peace, prosperity, and social justice, or will we allow ourselves to be seduced by the siren calls of isolationism and division? Are we prepared to work in partnership to confront the challenges of this century and together embrace opportunity? Or will we indulge in the myopia of some imagined mid-Atlantic future? A month after the collapse of the wall, Leonard Bernstein famously conducted an international orchestra in two performances of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony in East Berlin, notably transforming Schiller's Ode to Joy into an Ode to Freedom. The symbolism of this speaks to us now as clearly as it did then. Generations past and present have seen the bloody consequences of a Europe divided. But we have all lived and shared in the prosperity of a Europe united. As citizens of this great community of independent nations, let us stay together and work together for the prosperous and peaceful future.
Thank you. I call Graham Simpson to be followed by Claudia Beamish. Mr. Simpson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is the first time I've addressed Parliament in my role as one of the three Scottish Conservative MSPs for Central Scotland. And how good does that sound? I fear, though, that maybe not for the last time I could be severely outnumbered today, that there are so few MSPs on the side of the Leave campaign demonstrates that Parliament, on this issue at least, is not reflective of Scotland at large. I'm 52, that may surprise you. It surprises me sometimes. In my heart, I'm still the disco-dancing cool dude of my 20s.
Still are.
Indeed. Though my head tells me otherwise, I'll be going with my head at any MSP's parties. My age puts me in the bracket of the majority in this chamber who've never had the opportunity to vote on the UK's membership of what is now the EU. My parents did, my grandparents did, but they were sold a pop. No one asked the British people if they wanted to join the common market, as it was then. They were asked what we are now being asked, do you want to remain? They were asked if they want to stay in the common market. If I was asked that today, I would say yes. But that isn't what was on offer then, and it certainly isn't what is on offer now. Our leaders knew then that this wasn't merely a trade organisation. They knew it was a full-blown political project, and they deliberately didn't let on. So it's right that we are now, thanks to a Conservative government, getting the choice to accept or reject what Britain didn't vote for. And we must accept the result, whatever the outcome. This must be a once-in-a-generation vote, just as the Scottish referendum should have been a once-in-a-generation vote. On this issue, it's the Scottish Conservatives that most reflect public opinion in Scotland, more so than any of the other groups in this Parliament. Scottish Labour used to have a strong Eurosceptic element. It now seems to have abandoned its past. You would have thought SNP members would accept the unarguable logic of Jim Sillars. He says it makes no sense to suggest we should leave a union with our closest neighbours, only to jump into an even larger and more remote one elsewhere, giving away the powers you've just asked for back. But SNP parliamentarians, even if they agree with their former deputy leader, are not allowed to say so. Though I did read in the Scottish Sun this week that there is apparently one of them. Will they break cover today, I wonder? The choice on June the 23rd is to stay or leave. The question voters must ask themselves is really very simple. How do I want to be governed? That's what it comes down to in the end. We can argue about prices, the economy, immigration, security, and there are valid arguments on both sides in all these areas, but ultimately it comes down to this. Do I want decisions affecting my country to be taken by people out with these borders? Do I think it's right that unelected and unaccountable European judges can overturn decisions of democratically elected politicians? Do I think it's right that policies can be decided by unelected bureaucrats and imposed on this country? When the Scottish Government put forward its proposals for minimal alcohol pricing, I saw it as more nanny state politics from the SNP. But I absolutely thought they had the right to do it, having been elected by the people of Scotland. For that measure to be effectively blocked by the European Court of Justice was a disgrace. Why is it that so many in the political class want to remain? It could be that the EU serves them and their armies of bureaucrats very well. Those in the bubble are hardly likely to want to burst it. The EU is nothing but a political project. It's a first-class only gravy train with no stops, where the buffet car serves only the finest food and never mind the cost. And it's one way to ever closer union. We have the chance to pull the emergency cord and jump off to set ourselves on another freer course, able to spend the fair money, £350 million a week, on whatever we like. Leaving would hand powers to this Parliament over, for example, agriculture and fisheries. Why would anyone in this chamber not want that? There is a sign in the European Commission building in Brussels which reads, Europe, your country. That's what they believe. It's not what I believe, and anyone who agrees with me should be voting to leave on June the 23rd.
Thank you very much. I call Claudia Beamish to be followed by John Mason. Ms. Beamish.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Every country in the European Union and the global community strives to achieve a combination of national autonomy and international collaboration. This referendum must be framed both inwardly and outwardly facing, considering the impact of EU membership has in Scotland and the UK and the impact we have on other EU members. A progressive union is built on the principles of cooperation and solidarity, and these indeed lie at the heart of my decision to vote to remain a member. Membership has provided the opportunity for continent-wide collaboration on an improved trade market, better jobs, progress on women's and LGBT rights, and sustainable development. Over 3 million jobs in the UK are linked to our trade with the EU, and the EU market buys half of Britain's exports. Millions of livelihoods are interlinked with EU membership, and we must continue to pioneer this world-leading trade system. Not perfect, and I disagree with TTIP, but to be out would make it increasingly difficult. Beyond providing jobs, the EU social chapter means these jobs come with workers' rights, as has been described by many other members. Paternity leave, paid now, as well as maternity leave, and also part-time workers' rights and anti-discrimination laws. Where people argue we could have these things in a separate UK, I would point out that in other countries, workers may not be so lucky. Our voice is louder in chorus. With regards to environmental policy, the EU has been a driving force for progress. The environment does not have a public infrastructure to be monitored, which goes to heighten the importance of EU-regulated targets and deadlines. These issues are not confined to lines on a map, and neither should their regulation be. Our membership of the EU means influence and accountability. Scotland and the UK shaped EU emissions targets by advocating more ambitious policy, and at the Paris Climate Conference, our voice was louder as part of the union. Credit goes to ongoing EU regulation for tackling pollution levels and chemical manufacture and use. 50 years ago, our air had the highest level of sulfur dioxide emissions, as the Cabinet Secretary highlighted, and we were surrounded in some places, frankly, by sewer-like inshore waters, and these issues were stressed by Ross Grier. Policymakers reacted to problems after the damage was done, and regulation took on a more voluntary approach. Today, citizens of the EU are protected from these health and environmental risks. The Ambient Air Quality Directive sets legal limits on air pollution concentrations, and it is an important incentive to action to protect public health and the environment. The Scottish Government at present is breaking these legal requirements in several areas of Scotland and is currently in excess of the legal limits of nitrogen oxide, which have been set out in the directive, a serious environmental and social justice issue. And our EU membership ensures the Scottish Government is accountable for this failure and forces us to address improvement rapidly. The EU has also played a significant part in slowing and reversing biodiversity and habitat loss. The Biodiversity Strategy to 2020 and the EU Habitats and Birds Directives have played a vital role in collective management of land, sea and air. Nature knows no boundaries, and it is completely logical that we make collective arrangements for its protection and for the health management of our natural resources. Ash dieback is an example of how quickly we can act on this sort of an issue as an EU member. For many in South Scotland and other coastal and rural communities, the Common Fisheries Policy and the Common Agricultural Policy will be important in their decision. And I'm sure that Richard Lockhead's experience as a Cabinet Secretary previously will put these cases well. For reasons of production in the aftermath of World War II, as we know, farmers were given subsidies, and today these payments retain their importance. We must ask, if repatriated, will our farmers receive such a payment? Today, CAP payments go beyond supporting production, now including environmental incentives, which is, of course, of benefit to us all. I have serious concerns that without the EU, our farmers and fishing industries would suffer. This is about who we want to be, an outward-looking country ready to pool a small amount of our sovereignty to work with other countries to tackle the big questions, which always remembering that significant word, subsidiarity, which I took some time to learn, but now know what it means. Or are we to be inward-looking, focusing on the past and trying to hide from the big questions of tomorrow? We should not give up our influence over the character of Europe, a union born from the ideals of peace and democracy, with a significant role to play for and fight for a fair, sustainable and secure future. Let's stay.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I call John Mason, followed by John Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I congratulate the two most recent members who made their first speeches, Tom Arthur and Graham Simpson, although I would have to say my views are slightly closer to Tom Arthur's. So we have a referendum in 4 weeks, and clearly I do think the choice of date was extremely poor. All over many parts of the UK, we've just gone through major elections in London, Wales, Northern Ireland, as well as here in Scotland, but we are where we are. Just this morning, I was checking out of the hotel, and the receptionist asked what I thought of the EU and the referendum. She said she could see reasons for voting to stay in, but she also had reasons for voting to leave. So she was undecided and a bit confused about which way to go. And I have to say, I think her position is not unusual amongst many members of the public. Now, my very first vote as an 18-year-old was in 1975 in the last referendum. So it does have special meaning for me to be voting again in a similar referendum 41 years later. I just hope it does not set a precedent that 41 years should be the period between referenda. So why am I enthusiastic about the EU? Well, a number of reasons. One, I feel European. I think it does make a difference to have lived and worked outside of the UK, and in my case that was for 3 years in Nepal in the 1980s. I was part of an international non-government organisation with folk from all over the world working together. In that situation, you realise how much Europeans have in common. Now, I accept we should not stereotype people, but for me, the Dutch are generally the group I have felt closest to. They are also a small country. They share many words with us and have a very similar sense of humour, I think. Their religious history and mix is very similar, with a strong reform tradition and also Catholic tradition. Now, we will all probably have European countries that we feel close to, and the fact that there are 2 million UK citizens living in Europe and some 2 million from other European countries living in the UK does say a lot about mobility in Europe these days. Secondly, history. Mike Russell has been much more eloquent on that than I could be, but when you read the stories of Montrose, Mary Queen of Scots, David Hume, and figures in church history like John Knox and John Ogilvie, it's very clear that they all operated at a European level. Thirdly, as has been mentioned, peace since the Second World War. I was born 12 years after World War II, but it seemed like ancient history to me when I was younger. But when you read European history, it is like story after war after war after war. The EU in its various forms has been a major part of changing this. And I think the danger for my age group and younger is we forget how torn apart Europe has traditionally been, and we downplay that success at our peril. Fourthly, I feel safer in the EU than I do in the UK. Now, I accept the EU institutions are not perfect, and I would strongly support improvements, for example, more power for the Parliament. But at least the EU is attempting to be democratic. Whereas here in the UK, we do not even have an elected head of state, and one of the two chambers at Westminster is not elected. So I would rather be in a more democratic system like the EU than in a less democratic one like the UK. Okay, briefly.
Can I ask who elects the European Central Bank? Who elects the Commission? Can you answer those questions?
Civil servants like the European Commission are appointed in every country, including in the EU, by elected members, by government. So that is quite normal. There's no difference from that point of view. Now, in the same theme, the EU favours smaller nations, unlike the UK. At the Council of Ministers, for example, each country gets one seat. In the European Parliament, they use degressive proportionality, if I have the term right, which means voters in countries like Malta and Luxembourg have considerably more influence than citizens of the six largest countries. Now, we do something similar with the Western Isles, Orkney and Shetland, but it is not generally the way the UK operates. Of the 28 countries in Europe, only 12 have populations over 10 million, and a further four that are significantly larger than Scotland. So Scotland is very much a normal type of country in Europe, whereas the UK is clearly hopelessly imbalanced in favour of England. Fifthly, the concept of confederation as against federation. Now, I'm not sure confederation is a word we're using quite so much of these days, but the meaning being that the real power in Europe sits with the member states, a relatively few subjects where the EU has exclusive competence, and its member states who agree what is to be exclusive, what is to be shared, and what is to be supporting competence. I'm running out of time, but as mentioned by Fiona Hislop, Christina McKelvey and Mary Fee, the EU has proven to be fairer for workers than the UK has, and finally, the UK is really too small in a world of big players. So I very much support the Scotland and the UK remaining in the EU. Thank you.
John Scott, to be followed by Elaine Smith. Mr. Scott.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I first declare an interest as a farmer and food producer? And can I also say that it's great to be back in the chamber and able to take part in debates again? Deputy Presiding Officer, turning now to the subject in hand, I want to say I'm very much in the Remain camp in the European debate. But it's my own experience that places me there, apart from other reasons I will deal with later. And in my own business life, before politics, I've been involved in the creation of three working cooperatives, amongst them farmers' markets. And to my surprise and delight, when working with farmers who are people who do not naturally work collaboratively, I have found to my surprise and proved to my satisfaction that when one works together, the total is greater than the sum of the parts. It is the same in politics, it is the same in business, and it is the same with countries. That is why I was and remain totally opposed to Scotland breaking away from the United Kingdom, because Scotland working in union with England, Wales and Northern Ireland has achieved so much in the past and will do so in the future, working cooperatively and collaboratively with our neighbours, the total being greater than the sum of the parts. That is why I similarly believe the United Kingdom should be part of the EU, because working within the EU has helped the UK become the fifth wealthiest country in the world, and again, working together has created a total for the EU and the UK greater than the sum of its parts. Now, we can all see the problems of working together at whatever level, local, national or international, and any cooperative or union, be it the UK or the EU, is always a work in progress. It is never the finished article, because new obstacles and challenges come along, challenges that have to be overcome. But these are problems to be solved, not given up on. Throwing the baby out with the bathwater is not a solution, because the problem appears too difficult to resolve. Instead, we in the United Kingdom need to play a positive and active role in the EU, where we have so much to bring to the top table. If reform is needed, then propose solutions rather than exit strategies. If challenges exist, then face up to them together rather than run away from them. Create the political will to lead the 500 million people politicians across Europe represent to deal with what are the current problems. And making the case to remain is straightforward. Because by remaining in the EU, we will continue to develop trade with the EU and grow our economy, providing jobs and a secure future for our children and grandchildren. We will continue to develop our relationship with America and other English-speaking countries as one of their gateways and access points to Europe. We will continue to develop and grow our financial products and services market, so vital to employment in Scotland and England. And as Richard Lockhead said, we will continue to export our Scottish food and drink to Europe, our biggest market by far, protecting and enhancing our precious jobs in urban and rural Scotland. We can bring UK help and expertise to bear and help solve the problems of the euro, of a bankrupt Greece, of the refugee crisis. Everything is doable with the right mindset, and in my view, it's time to get on with solving the problems of Europe rather than adding to them by leaving. And in less than 1 month's time, we will have to make our choice to leave or remain within the EU. The decision will boil down to who has made the most credible argument. And for my part, I believe David Cameron and George Osborne when they say it is in the best interest of our economy, our country and our future to remain part of the EU, and not just because they are Conservatives, but because they now have a six-year track record of delivering for and restoring the fortunes of the United Kingdom, of which Scotland is such a vital part. I believe the many others who have the best interests of Scotland and the UK at heart, our friends President Obama, Angela Merkel, François Hollande. I believe our senior military and defence staff too, who believe our security is enhanced by being part of the EU. I believe Christian Lagarde of the IMF and our many distinguished business leaders who support remaining part of the EU. Indeed, as the rest of the world is coalescing into larger and larger trading blocks with an ever-increasing number of bilateral agreements, why would we willingly be erecting barriers to trade and risking our security at the same time? The Leave campaign simply has not demonstrated any reasonable case in strategic terms for breaking away from the EU. So I urge the people of Scotland and the UK to vote to remain in the EU for the benefit of all UK citizens, our children and grandchildren. Thank you.
Elaine Smith to be followed by Stuart Stevenson. Ms. Smith.
Many thanks, Presiding Officer, for giving me the opportunity to put a different perspective in this debate. And like my colleague John Scott, it's good to be back in the Chamber making a contribution to a substantial debate. So far, I've been listening to the wider EU debate, and I think one of the worst aspects is the extent to which it's been dominated by the right, and quite often with racist undertones. So I think it's important that a legitimate left-wing case for leaving is actually voiced in the debate. The key argument of the official stay campaign, and I should say I'm not in any official campaign, Presiding Officer, but the key argument of the official stay campaign seems to be that things can only get worse if we leave. But that ignores the role that the EU has actually played in intensifying austerity and reactionary politics. And I do appreciate that colleagues on the Labour benches, many colleagues are enthusiastic about staying, as outlined by Kezia Dugdale. But from a left perspective, I think that there is a need to assess what the EU is, and based on that, what route is most likely to offer the best prospects for the working class and employment rights. And personally, I'm not convinced that it is part of an undemocratic super state with mass unemployment, falling living standards and growing inequality. And we only have to look to the Greek tragedy and 50% of youth unemployment in Spain to see that. Presiding Officer, there are undoubtedly many on the left who are going to hold their noses and vote to remain in the hope that reforms will come. I understand that, but I think that with an unelected bureaucracy at its core and a largely decorative parliament, that avoids the reality that the EU structures are so closely bound to capitalism. In fact, the original title of the EU, the Common Market, told socialists then it was essentially capitalist and designed to reverse the socialist advances that were made in Western Europe after World War II. Those advances were built on issues like public ownership of key utilities and industries, the creation of welfare states, redistributive taxation, and management by the state of the economy to ensure full employment. Of course, Britain was originally locked out of the EEC club by French vetoes because they believed, correctly, that it would use its influence to advance the interests of US capital. The interests of workers, by contrast, are important only insofar as their consent or the absence of organised opposition can be achieved. Of course, at this point, someone no doubt mentions the social chapter of the Maastricht Treaty. However, that treaty was introduced to develop the single market and the monetary union, and the social chapter was included because it was recognised that increased labour movement resistance to worsening economic conditions could actually derail the whole EU project. In Britain, equality, health and safety laws, the Working Time Directive and other benefits included in the social chapter of course seemed very attractive due to the aggressive market-led capitalist approach of Tory governments. But I think it's also important to note the limited nature of the social chapter. So key areas in relation to the class struggle, like pay and the right to strike, were not included. The reality is that most of the key rights that we still enjoy don't stem from the EU. They stem from struggles undertaken collectively by trade unions in this country. For example, paid holidays and equal pay. The EU, of course, has provided some individual as opposed to collective rights like TUPE, but that was only to limit resistance to EU-imposed privatisation and competitive tendering. And individual rights for agency workers were introduced to mitigate the effects of casualisation, which the EU in itself helped to create. The EU works on the basis of the primacy of the market, and collective labour organisation is seen as an impediment to effective markets. Of course, what we have seen is endless pro-business directives, ending public ownership of rail and utilities, introducing CCT in the public sector, allowing companies to pay workers from other states at rates lower than the locally agreed rates. And that agenda has impacted directly on Scotland. We've heard some of this in other speeches. But the Scottish Government claims, I want to make this point, they claim that it was the EU that enforced the re-tendering of CalMac with the threat of privatisation. And that is one of the reasons why the RMT union are so keen for their members to vote Leave. Currently, both CETA and TTIP are being negotiated secretly by the unelected Commission, and if agreed, they will be a huge threat to our public services here in Scotland. The treaties are a corporate power grab. They will undermine our democracy, and what they will do is give businesses a right to sue governments. And that's absolutely terrifying. Presiding officer, the EU is not Europe. It's a political construct imposed upon the people of Europe to undermine democratic national governments. And it seeks the effective elimination of any genuine elective democracy. And I would say very strongly that that runs contrary to the true definition of internationalism. Since its foundation, the EU has had a clear direction of travel, opening up public services to privatisation, eroding collective bargaining and centralising power. And unfortunately, I don't see enough of the debate on this EU referendum on either side addressing these fundamental points. Voting to remain will inevitably allow this agenda to continue in the face of minimum opposition and with little hope, I have to say, of any real reform. Voting Leave could help to reassert the power of working people over that of big business. Politically, of course, that would be much more likely if we elect a Labour government in 2020. John Foster, in his case for Leave, says it's essential to put forward and win a positive progressive case against Cameron's EU, a vision of renewed democracy, a restored welfare state and a redevelopment of public control over the economy, a vision that can combat racism, cynicism and division and unite all working people. And I believe that whatever way people vote, they should be aware of the true nature of the EU. And, presiding officer, personally, I intend to vote Leave and I will not be supporting the motion tonight. Thank you.
We're now moving to the last speaker in the open session, so all those who've taken part in the debate should make sure they're back in the chamber for the closing speeches. Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you very much, presiding officer, and let me congratulate you on your elevation to your position. I will crave a boon from you at some point in the future. Let's get in credit at the outset. I'm happy to join our fellow rebel, Mike Russell, as someone who, like him, voted yes in 1975. Not because the arguments were absolutely decisive and compelling, but because as a child born in the immediate aftermath of the war that ended in 1945, the value that I placed on international collaboration in the cause of peace overrode other considerations. John Mason talked about 41 years, and interestingly enough, 41 years before the 1975 referendum, there was another referendum on whether the United Kingdom should remain a member of the League of Nations. It wasn't organised by the government, but it was a mass franchise open to the voting of everyone in the United Kingdom. 38% of the electorate chose to vote, and 96% of them said, we want to remain part of that international organisation. I crave that we achieve such an overwhelming result on the 23rd of June, but I'm not holding my breath. And for Elaine Smith, I say a further 41 years back, the inaugural meeting of the Independent Labour Party took place in Bradford, chaired, of course, by Keir Hardie. So there must be something about 41 years in politics. It's also the case that the debate around how we should engage with each other is not particularly new. In 1606, in the Westminster Parliament, it was said, if we admit them into our liberties, we shall be overrun with them. There was a fear that if Scotland and England joined together, the English would be overrun with the Scots. And in that debate in 1606, they went on to say, witness the multiplicities of the Scots in Poland. Today, part of the debate is the number of people who are using the free movement of peoples across Europe to come to our shores. There are 2 million of UK citizens have moved elsewhere, including substantial numbers of my family. But in the 17th century, the 18th century, the 19th century, and the early 20th century, there were substantial migrations of Scots went to many of those countries, in particular to Poland, to the extent that there are areas in both Warsaw and Krakow called New Scots, New Scotland, and in a city that is now part of Poland, Danzig, there is also an area called New Scotland. So the Scots are, if we're anything, people of international interest. I may say I'm very happy to recruit Margaret Mitchell and Graham Simpson to the campaign to abolish the House of Lords. Margaret said an argument against the EU is that nobody knows who the MEPs are. Well, I'll bet you'll not get many people knowing the names of people in the House of Lords. I don't even know those which might claim Scottish connection, and I'm involved in politics. And Graham Simpson, I think, made remarks that would support that as well. Let me just conclude by saying, when I made my first speech on the 14th of June 2001, I referred to fisheries policy bringing zonal management. We've seen some progress in the common fisheries policy, but I think it would be fair to say the overwhelming majority of my skippers who catch fish in the North Sea and elsewhere are likely to be voting no, because the common fisheries policy is one of the great failures of the EU. We have been making progress, and I think we'll continue to make progress. On the other hand, for those who produce fish products and who export fish, the free movement of goods across borders allows fresh products that will perish very rapidly to make it to the markets of the EU and to generate huge economic benefit. So I think the fishing industry is deeply divided between those who produce our products and rely on access to the wider market and those who are sharing the bounty of the seas in a very unfair way. Reform is needed. Reform is probably coming. I encourage the UK, who will have the European presidency in the second half of next year, to take a much more proactive role in promoting the interests of those who catch fish in our seas. Presiding Officer.
We now move to closing speeches, and I call Lewis MacDonald, up to 6 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and welcome to you to the Chair this afternoon. The formal record of today's debate will appear to show a high degree of consensus on a hugely important issue. A brief and uncontroversial government motion, no amendments from opposition parties, an overwhelming vote in favour with every party leader voting the same way. Not much, perhaps, to suggest that this is one of the most critical decisions our generation will face, or that many people here in Scotland still have to make up their minds. As Fiona Hislop said, and I thank her for her welcome, referendums reduce debates to a binary choice, for or against, in or out, when on this, as on other issues, many people can see arguments both ways. And those who vote in favour of continued membership of the European Union will do so on the basis of quite different visions for the future of Scotland and of Britain and of Europe, as indeed will those who vote to leave. Labour support for remaining in the EU is firmly based on the collective view of our party conference and based, as Kezia Dugdale said this morning, on the proposition that sovereignty shared is sovereignty gained. As Mary Fee said, we believe that by the strength of our common endeavour, we achieve more than we achieve alone. And that ambition for achieving more together is not limited to the people of Scotland or of the United Kingdom or indeed of the European Union. Our common endeavour is a universal principle and applies to all. Gordon Brown wrote recently, for example, of the vital role the European Union can play in working for stability and hope in the Middle East and in Africa. Those are vital objectives, both for those regions and for Europe itself. And that too speaks to our common humanity. In today's debate, Daniel Johnson laid out the benefits of membership of the European Union for his constituents in terms of investment, education and jobs. And what is true of Edinburgh Southern is also true of Scotland as a whole. And I congratulate him and all of those other new members who spoke in this debate and all made very strong contributions from their different points of view. I welcome those from different parties who have stressed the need for reform of the European Union, to support people here and across Europe, to support them against the damage done by austerity policies from national governments. We want a European Union which builds on Europe's best democratic traditions, not simply a common market for the free movement of capital. And of course, the socialist case to remain is the polar opposite of the conservative case to leave, which was put today by Margaret Mitchell and Graeme Simpson. We reject the idea that free movement of people is a one-way deal or a burden on public services. We recognise that the free movement of workers must instead go hand in hand with shared high standards of workers' rights. And we believe that government must invest in public services, not simply let market forces take their course. Our aspiration is to widen the circle of shared values, of common endeavour and of equal rights as far as is practically possible. We want, for example, as a number of speakers have said, to protect the rights of people at work, rights to paid holiday, rights to parental leave, rights to equal treatment and to safe working environments. And we will, as a party, use the powers of the Scottish Parliament where we can, and we will work with other parties here which share that agenda. But whenever we get the opportunity to legislate on these matters for the whole of the United Kingdom, we will do that as well, because that way 10 times as many working people will benefit from those laws. And we will embed those rights in European law when that opportunity arises, because then they will benefit 100 times more people than live in Scotland alone. And the rights of people at work in Scotland are enhanced every time we succeed in winning the same rights for people in England, Wales and Northern Ireland, and every time we succeed in winning those same rights across the EU. Because the wider the reach of progressive legislation, the harder it is for unscrupulous employers or governments to promote a race to the bottom at working people's expense. And the harder it then becomes to impose policies of austerity, which are at the expense of working people. And it is for those same reasons that trade unions like the Labour Party not only share our values, but also in the main, and Elaine Smith has mentioned some exceptions, but in the main share our views on the European Union, including what needs to be done to make it work better. A socialist case, as Jeremy Corbyn has said, for the European Union, but also for reform and progressive policies within the European Union. And as Dave Ward of the Communication Workers Union said last month, the EU is far from perfect, but it is necessary for tackling inequality, tax avoidance, climate change, and preventing workers being exploited across Europe. Those points have been made in the debate today. They are, I think, points which unite many in this chamber. But it is not for its own sake that we in this party back any state or any union, European or otherwise. It's for the good it can do and the difference it can make. And that, for Labour, is what this debate is all about.
I call John Lamont, up to 8 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I add my words of welcome to yourself and your new role as Deputy Presiding Officer? With less than a month to go, we're coming into the home straight of the debate to decide our future in Europe. The debate this morning has been an incredibly useful opportunity for this newly elected Scottish Parliament to discuss the issues at stake ahead of this important decision. I congratulate all of those members who have delivered their maiden speeches during the course of this morning's debate. There is clearly some divergence of opinion across the Chamber, just as there is some divergence of opinion across Scotland. Like many others in the Remain camp, I do not pretend that the European Union is perfect. This was a point well made by my colleague Adam Tomkins in his excellent maiden speech. But on balance, I believe the Prime Minister has negotiated a better deal for the United Kingdom in the European Union, which allows Britain to continue to play a leading role in one of the world's largest international organisations with a special status within that EU framework. The Prime Minister has stressed there is need for further and continuing reform, but there's little doubt Britain is best placed to do that from a position of influence inside the EU fold. If it were to leave the EU but still have access to the single market, then that level of access would likely not be the same as it is now. We only need to look at Norway and Switzerland as examples of that. We would still have to pay into the EU budget and accept the free movement of people as the price of that access. And we would still be the subject to all the EU rules, but would have no say over the creation of these rules. I'll give way to Mr. Findlay.
Seriously pointing to the impoverished Norwegians and Swiss as an example of what not to do.
Mr. Lamont.
I think on balance, the overall package of the European Union is better able to address those challenges in those countries than what we would be individually as separate nations. Now, I understand that for some, the UK's ongoing participation in the European project is an emotive matter, with questions of sovereignty and control at its core. My colleague Margaret Mitchell highlighted her concerns and her contribution, as did Graham Simpson in his maiden speech. But it seems to me that far from halting the constitutional creep of the EU and restoring the UK's sovereignty over its decision-making, we would find ourselves more constrained than we are with the status quo. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, Mr. Findlay rightly highlighted the SNP's hypocrisy over the EU referendum. It's odd, to say the least, that the SNP are now strongly promoting one union when they passionately argued against another, one which more clearly benefits Scotland. That one union, which Scotland has 10% of elected representatives, is somehow undemocratic, yet another union, where we have less than 2% of MEPs, is acceptable. That one union, which represents £46 billion worth of Scotland's trade, is worth leaving, but we should risk leaving another union which represents £13 billion of trade. But the SNP haven't stopped there, Deputy Presiding Officer, publicly pinning Scotland's constitutional future on the outcome of the EU referendum. Mr. Russell highlighted the SNP's continuing desire to break up yet again during his contribution this morning. For many people in Scotland and across the United Kingdom, I believe that the case for remaining in the EU is not so much an emotive one, but a practical one. It certainly is for me. So instead of abstract ideas, let's look at concrete benefits. As the UK's major trading partner, the EU accounts for 44% of UK exports. More than 3 million jobs in Britain are linked to our trade with other EU countries. And overall, the independent CBI estimates that through lower prices and increased trade and investment, each household across the country on average benefits by £3,000 a year from EU membership. Daniel Johnson highlighted the economic benefits in his maiden speech for his own constituency, but the same arguments apply across the whole of Scotland. The Prime Minister has consistently argued that the main overriding purpose of European Union membership is to secure prosperity. Since the Eurozone crisis boiled over in 2009, the EU has perhaps become more connected with financial instability rather than economic prosperity. But these figures show that despite the widespread economic turmoil that has defined the past few years, EU membership still benefits us, not just at a national level, but in people's pockets too. For many of my constituents in the borders with farm businesses, the EU also offers a critical level of support to the common agricultural policy. In fact, nearly 40% of the European budget is dedicated to the agriculture sector. And EU membership also offers tariff-free market access for Scottish produce, which has an export value of £5.1 billion in 2014, a fact that every business across the country should and will be aware of. The NFUS rightly argues that the European negotiating position has allowed international trade agreements to be opened with around 50 partners in recent years, opening up new markets for Scottish produce. We don't know what the alternative would be if the UK votes to leave. What trade barriers would be imposed? The future is extremely uncertain, and that's bad for the agriculture sector and bad for our economy as a whole. So much of the leave rhetoric surrounding the UK membership of the EU has focused on the constraints it supposedly places on our sovereignty, our freedom to exercise autonomy and independence on issues affecting our laws, our borders, and our global trade. But to my mind, weighted against the costs, the benefits of staying in the EU are clear. Together with many of my Conservative colleagues, I'll continue to make a strong and convincing case to remain in the EU. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I now call Fiona Hislop to close this debate. Cabinet Secretary, you have around 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful to members for the contributions today in this chamber. And Presiding Officer, isn't it the case that this chamber really does rise to the occasion when we are addressing the big issues facing our people and communities? And I hope that the new members who have spoke extremely well today can see this as a prospect for the way forward. There clearly is an overwhelming enthusiasm, not absolute enthusiasm, no doubt, from this chamber for continued membership of the EU, and many cases and very good points have been made during this debate. And I think it is incumbent on those of us that can contribute during the next month to make sure that our voices are heard loudly and clearly in the short time that's left ahead of the vote on the 23rd of June. First speakers today, we heard from Adam Tompkins. I think the best bit of his speech was his reference to Glasgow as the first European city of culture. Daniel Johnson, as many others did, paid tribute to their predecessor, very much appreciated by members across the chamber. But he spoke specifically about the role of universities and the financial sector in this city in particular. Ross Greer, I thought, made an excellent speech, and again, welcome to your post in that regard for the Green Party. Again, very eloquent about what young people want is to reach out and communicate and connect in the world, and that part of the debate must not be lost. And Alex Cole-Hamilton, I thought, made a very articulate contribution in terms of his own constituency, but also looking at the opportunities and thinking about things from a very personal perspective. And how powerful was Tom Arthur's reflection on reminding us of what it felt like at the time of the Berlin Wall and the desire of young people, particularly again, to contribute and connect, and that personal reflection that many people have in this debate. And Graham Simpson, although he was on the other side of the debate, set out his case. And I think it's always important that in this chamber, if we do disagree, we listen with respect and we argue those points. In terms of some of the aspects in the debate itself, some outstanding speeches, particularly from Richard Lockhead, a very close colleague who has for a long time been a strong champion for Scotland in the EU. And he spoke about his own constituency, Murray. I also talked about the exports in his constituency, Walker's Baxter's, the whisky industry, so important to Scotland and our exports. And he also talked about that historical reflection, as did Mike Russell. It's very important that we do think about this debate, about what the EU has achieved and why its existence, very existence, is there from a historical perspective, but also of the present and the future as well. In terms of other points, Kezia Dugdale brought, I thought, a debate to a reflective perspective, thinking about the beauty and the importance of articulating the mix of cultures that is alive in this city and indeed in others, and how the EU has brought from a conflict and chaos situation peace and prosperity. But there were also some hard points made in the debate and some concerns raised, and I think particularly from Margaret Mitchell, who seemed rather confused
about saying that she wanted to complain and blame the EU for the UK's trade figures without acknowledging the importance of the growth of emerging markets, and then basing her argument on the need to have unilateral trade agreements with those new and emerging markets. And from the other spectrum of the side, how often do the right and left meet? Elaine Smith, concerned and setting out a case about what would happen with future trade agreements within the EU. But the question is, what would happen out with the EU and an unfettered free market Conservative government in terms of any relations and trade deal it had with the US? Do we really think that some of the protections that we are seeking for the NHS and other services would be part of any revised agreement? And also in terms, I want to move on, and also in terms of the points made by Graeme Smith, reflected by others in relation to the issue on minimum unit pricing. Minimum unit pricing hasn't been blocked. The preliminary ruling of the ECG indicates that it will be for member states' domestic courts to make a final decision on minimum unit pricing. But the desire to connect, the desire to make sure that we can build, as Ross Grier said, a people's Europe, those are aspirations, and that is the type of arguments we have. What type of country do we want to be part of? What type of country do we want to provide leadership for? And what type of country do we want to see shaping the world around us? And of course, when we look at this debate from the prism of Scotland, there is a strong civic case for the EU membership, as reflected by a number of our organisations. The Scottish Council for Development and Industry has said the CDI is entirely confident in stating that if the UK remains in the EU, it would be better for the Scottish economy if accurate represents the position of our majority of our members. And in SCDI's view, the EU is an essential foundation for Scotland's international trade and investment. COSLA, given the importance of the issue, we took a paper on the EU referendum to our full convention. And David O'Neill said, I'm pleased to say that there was agreement from the political groups within COSLA that it would campaign to remain within the European Union. The Scottish Trades Unions Congress, the General Council, believes that the option that aligns best with the STUC's economic and social justice objectives is for the UK to remain a member of the EU. The Church of Scotland, 24th of May, Reverend Sally Foster Fulton, for the last 20 years, we have recognised the European Union's achievements in promoting peace and security, and we have reaffirmed that position today. NFU Scotland, President Alan Bowie has said a robust debate amongst our board of directors and wider membership looking at the economic arguments around the EU has seen NFU Scotland come off the fence in favour of remaining in the EU at the current time. And that is a position shared amongst other UK farming unions. Now, we heard from Claire Adamson also about the university, the importance of Horizon 2020. And it's not about just about the history and the present benefits of the EU. It's what we can do in shaping the future, challenging and taking on the big issues and the big economic opportunities for the future, but also the invention, the research, the leading lights of democracy, debate and innovation and invention. And these things are all capable and capable, yes, outside the EU, but how much better is it in the ability to connect with so many of the cities, the institutions, the creative economies that are abroad in the EU. So in terms of some of those areas and those arguments, Claudia Beamish, I thought, made a very informed debate point about natural resources and the importance to our environment. And John Mason, I thought, touched on one of the points as we talk about the EU in the abstract. We're actually talking about collaboration with our friends in the Netherlands, with Dutch people, with Germans, with French, with peoples who make out those connections and help shape what we do going forward. And in terms of some of the other contributions in particular, I want to reflect on Mary Fee's point. She made a very passionate case about working women and what the EU meant for working women. And we have to take the abstract from the institutional and make it personal and make it real. And she did that in an excellent contribution as well. It's very rare, perhaps, that we have these debates where we can get consensus across the chamber. And I'm very pleased that we can do that. And in terms of summing up and in conclusion, Presiding Officer,
not just as are we responsible for articulating the case, we bring the voices of Scotland into this chamber. We've all spent a number of weeks on the doorsteps. I talked about the civic institutions and their voices. We can argue our party's position, we can argue our personal position, but our foremost responsibility is to reflect wider Scotland and bring their voices into the chamber. And I think that has been done in the debate today. And I want to look at the task ahead about how, from our different perspectives, we can agree on the importance of Scotland's European membership. And if, like me, you support Scotland and the UK remaining in the European Union, we must take that case enthusiastically, with passion, but with reason and the rational case that the Scottish voters expect from the politics and the debates that we have from this chamber, but out, more importantly, in society and the economy at large. And through our EU membership, the people of Scotland have enjoyed many opportunities. The right to live, work and study abroad. That chance to cooperate with like-minded people across Europe. And that opportunity must be there for future generations. But we should never, ever forget the birthplace of that cooperation across Europe. And I think with Mike Russell's contribution and indeed others, remaining grounded in that perspective and the importance of a union of 28 members that has sustained that period in peace and prosperity, I think is very, very important. And it's important that future generations can enjoy those same benefits and assume a leading role in the EU. And I want to finish, perhaps unusually, on a contribution by a Conservative member. I thought John Scott, an excellent contribution, said that it was important to help solve the problems of Europe rather than add to them. And I think the voice of Scotland is not just about what we get from Europe in material terms. It's what we can contribute. It's what we can give. It is a case of arguing what we can give in the wider world, not just what we can get. And I think that, ultimately, is the big argument of the big horizon, the big picture of why we should cooperate with our colleagues across Europe and remain in the European Union.
That concludes the debate on Scotland in the European Union, and I now suspend this meeting until 2 o'clock.